Signals are all good and we're heading out on drive so long just to see what we can find. So it's not the start of the show just yet. It's just a teaser, really. Just a teaser. I just want to have a look now. I heard a Franklin, a little ground bird Franklin alarm calling. I just want to have a look around here and see if we can maybe find him or see what he was alarm calling at. It's always good to have a look. It's always good to have a look around when you do hear birds alarm calling. They're a good little sign that there might be something, some predator around here. The bush is very thick at the moment though, and I can't really see too well. And it could be anything, but I do think there's something around there. I wonder. I wonder if I can't drive in. It's a very, very warm afternoon. Very, very hot. So I'm sure most of the predators would be resting around about now. That Franklin is really not happy. How much time do we have left of pre-show? I think I might just hang around here a little bit and maybe walk in there shortly and go and have a look and see if I can't find what this Franklin is alarm calling at. You never know. It's always worth having a look, checking out what is in the area. And like I say, it could be anything. It could just be a little snake that it's seen, or it could be potentially a predator walking around that area or lying close to that bird. So we'll go have a look shortly. See if we can find some shade. And we've got some school drives again this afternoon, and we're going to welcome all of them shortly. It's always great to have young viewers watching and asking questions, hopefully learning a lot while they're out here. And then our plan this afternoon is we're going to try to look for some big cats. This morning we went and we saw those beautiful little wildebeest calves, which was fantastic. It's the first for the season. Brand new wildebeest calves, one that was born this morning. Very exciting. But we'll see what else we can find this afternoon. Jamie had a lot of luck. She saw two leopards and she saw the male lion. What else did she see? Yeah, she saw quite a bit. That's a very, very lucky morning. I'm just listening. It sounds like that Franklin has stopped calling, but it might still be worthwhile just to have a quick look there. So I might do that, and Brent is going to be on game drive this afternoon with me, and Jamie's going to be on the bush walk, which is wonderful. So a few of us out. And we'll hopefully all be able to find you some really interesting little creatures this afternoon. Who knows what the afternoon holds for us. Can still hear those Franklins. They're still in that area, so I might go have a look there quickly. It's nice. This is all part of the preparation, working out where to go and what to look for. All right, we're going to start the show very soon. We'll see you a little bit later.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Well, the clouds rolled in just in time to give us a break from the harsh African sun. We're in search of all of South Africa's incredible wildlife. This is Safari Live.
Ready?
Standing by.
Welcome to Windsor Woods at Trantwood and Creeds Elementary for your very own school drive here in the middle of the African bush. Now, I'm looking for leopards, and when I look for leopards, I like to pretend to be a leopard. So I'm standing on top of a termite mound, because if I was a leopard and I was walking through here, I would stop up here and I'd look around and I'd see if there were any animals I could catch for my dinner. But alas, no leopards in sight from up here, so we're going to keep going on a wonderful adventure through the African bush, and remember to ask us as many questions as possible. We're very excited to have you all with us, and hopefully you're going to have some fun. This is much better than a normal school class. So let me know what you think. What do you want to know about lions, leopards, elephants, cheetahs, and all the other things, bugs, spiders, trees, flowers even. We are waiting to hear from you. So we're looking for a female leopard. And her last footprints were coming into this area, so we're just checking very carefully. Hello, Brody. Brody would like to know, does our car have four-wheel drive? Indeed it does, Brody. These are very, very strong 4x4s, and we're able to go into some incredibly difficult places. We've also got really big tires. And as you can see, no windscreen, no roof, so we can see all around us, and so we can spot little creatures like that one. Don't run away, stay. There we go. That is a little antelope called a steenbok. Oh, there she goes. Now that's not a baby, that's a big adult. And it's called a steenbok because of one of its ways it hides from leopards. So steen means brick or rock in Afrikaans, which is a language here. And when a leopard's very close, the steenbok won't run. It'll lie down and it'll keep so still like a rock. So the leopard walks straight past it. So that's one of the ways, but being little, it avoids the big predators, and that's where it gets its name from. It's basically a rock buck or a brick buck. Now, hello Hayden. Hayden wants to know, do we get gazelles here? Hayden, we don't. Gazelles only occur up in East Africa, from Tanzania up to the north. Here, we've got lots of different antelope, and we've seen one. Hopefully, we can find you a few more while we look for this leopard. We get impala, kudu, inyala, bushbuck. What am I missing? What a duiker. What a wildebeest. There we go. I think that's about all of them. Oh, there's an impala. Let me go forward a little bit. Oh, that's a better one. Now, hello Hayden. There we go, there's an antelope. And you can see that's a boy because he's got horns. Hayden wants to know, why does an antelope have big ears? Well, Hayden, so they can hear all the noises around them to make sure lions and leopards and things like that don't sneak up on them. And you can see how the ears are facing different directions, so it can listen to different places at the same time. It's one of the ways they try to avoid the big cats. Now it's really hot out here today. It's about 32 degrees Celsius, so 83 Fahrenheit. So it is a very, very warm. But luckily, as we got going, a big cloud is giving us a little bit of shade. Well, let's keep moving. Now, you guys are so lucky because there's not just me, and my name is Brent, And on camera with me is VM out here taking you on your own safari. You've got Byron and Jamie as well. But first, let's go meet Byron.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Byron, and on camera with me this afternoon is Gert. And it's lovely to have all of you with us. And I've just found some impala. I know Brent was looking at some impala too. But it looks like these impala all have little lambs. There's a few little lambs around here. Let's see if we can see some for you. And let's just have a good look. There we go. Look at that. Look at the beautiful little impala lambs. And all of them would have been born within the last week or two, literally within the last week, so they're very, very young. Nolan, you want to know how fast an antelope can run. Now, those impala aren't quite running away from us, but they're moving through the thicket, and we're probably going to lose them soon. But Nolan, but the antelope in this area can run very, very fast, especially these impala. They, I don't know the exact speed, but it's probably around, let's say, between 40 and 60 miles an hour, somewhere around there. Very, very fast. If they are running at full speed, very, very, very quick and very agile. They can change direction very well. And from a question from Trentwood Elementary, good afternoon to all of you. You want to know, do all antelope have horns? So technically, all the antelope species, yes, they do have horns, but with certain species, it might be only the male that has horns and the females don't. With some of the antelope, you might get the males and the females that have horns. And let me show you an example quickly of some. So, for example, let's just have a look at... Okay, it's a nice one. I'm just trying to see what we get in this area so I can show you. Wildebeest, and then let's look at the impala. Okay. Alright, so we get wildebeest in this area, and they are part of the antelope species, believe it or not. So I'll just hold that still for you. And the males and the females have horns. And so that's one species of antelope that we get in this area where the males and the females have horns. And then on this side we have the impala that we can see, that we've just seen. And the females don't have horns, but the males do. Do you see that? So that's also different. And then there are many other different species of antelope in the area where sometimes the males have horns and the females don't. Now, Morgan, you wanted to know, do the impalas sometimes fight with one another? And they do indeed. It's mainly the males, though. The females won't fight with one another, but the males do. And the reason for that is the males will fight to try and be dominant. Unfortunately, those impala have moved off now. We can't see them anymore, but I was hoping to show you a male. We'll try to look for some at some point again. But the males fight each other when they're trying to be dominant over one another and fight for a little piece of territory so they can attract females into that area. So they will fight, and that's why they have the horns, is to fight and spar with each other. So they try and show which one is stronger and which one is more dominant than the other one. All right, let's carry on. So Tyler, most of these antelope only have one baby at a time. They don't give birth to two or more. It's very, very rare that you get twins born. I've never seen it happen before, but usually it's only one little baby or lamb for some of the antelope, like these impalas. They're called lambs, so it's one lamb per female. And let's have a look. We might have some around the corner. I think I see some impala. Hold on a second. There we go. There's another little female with her lamb. Just through there. Look at that. See, so that would be the mother on the left, and that's the little lamb on the right. Staying very, very close to the mother. and they're still very vulnerable, which means they have to be careful of predators, and that female will try to look after that little lamb. Isn't that cute? So wonderful. Those long, thin legs. And isn't it amazing how very soon after they are born, they can stand up and start running around already? Oh, that is so cute. Eli, you've asked an interesting question, and you want to know, why do antelope have a white tail? So these impala, you do see it very clearly if they flick their tail around. Let's see if that female does it again. So it's actually just white underneath. Now, Eli, there's some theories to it, but I would say the main theory is that when they are startled, I just want to listen. Sorry, I thought I heard some impala calling behind us. But Eli, anyway, so the tails of these impala, with that very white tuft underneath, if they feel threatened, often what happens, they lift their tails up and you see that white flash very, very clearly, the white tuft under the tail. Now, the reason for that, or the theory, and what people think, it's there so that if they're running away from danger, they can perhaps follow one another to safety. So all the tails will be up and that white flash will then allow the other impala to follow them perhaps away from danger. And that is one of the theories. It's not really proven, and it's what scientists think and what people who have studied it think, because a lot of the antelope have different white markings or markings on their rump that are able to cause the rest of the herd to perhaps follow one another away from danger and to safety. So that is generally why they have that white tuft. We are going to try and look for some lions and leopards this afternoon. That's going to be our plan. Now, while I do that, we're going to head to Jamie, who's out on her bushwalk this afternoon.
And a very good afternoon to all of you, and welcome on the Sunset Safari, and a very warm welcome to all of our schools that are watching. My name is Jamie, and this afternoon the man holding the camera is Jandre, and we are heading out into the bush on foot to see if we can't help Brent find that leopard that he's been looking for. So we found some very, very fresh tracks, and we're slowly but surely trying to follow them through a dense area to see where she might be hiding. Perhaps on a day like today, with as much wind as that has been blowing, perhaps she might even have managed to catch something. So we're going to see if we can't figure out where she is. But for us on the walk, it's not just about the big animals. It's also about finding some of the small things as well and talking about some of the smaller things. But before we do that, Jeremy, good afternoon to you. You wanted to know, what do leopards eat? Leopards eat small antelope. So it depends on whether it's a big leopard or a little leopard. If it's a big male leopard, then they can go for much bigger antelope. If it's a small female leopard, then they usually like to target smaller antelope. Something like an impala, perhaps. You might see an impala with Brent or Byron, or something like a dacre or a steenbok. Now, speaking about dacre and steenbok, I want to show you there's evidence here that there are, in fact, these types of antelope out here somewhere in the area that we're in. So this is antelope dung, these tiny, tiny little pellets. Oopsie, dropping some. And the fact that they are as small as they are immediately tells me that it is a tiny antelope. And the fact that they are out in the open like this tell me that they belong to a small antelope called a dacre. Now, Karula, the leopard that we're looking for, she's very, very good at hunting and catching the dacre. But before we go and see if we can find her, I want to just show you something interesting about antelope dung. See how fine, let me try and hold it nice and still for you. See how fine the grass is from where they've been digesting it. And that's because antelope actually end up chewing their food twice. They chew it the first time and then they swallow it. and then they bring it back up again, out of their stomach, back into their mouths, which sounds really gross, but actually isn't too bad. They chew it again, and then they swallow it once again. And what that means is that they make sure that that food is really, really well ground up, and that they can digest it really fantastically. And that's in complete contrast to this animal. Now, this animal, this is very old, but this animal is something very large. And look here, you can actually, it's got lots of sand through it because this is such old dung that the termites have been living in it. But you can actually see pieces of the grass that this animal was eating, and sticks and twigs and leaves. And this animal is an elephant. And an elephant is not nearly as good as digesting its food as some of the antelope species. Now, it might seem really gross touching the dung, but it's not gross. You must never touch any poo of any animal unless you have been told it's okay by an adult. But because I know what the elephant's eaten, I'm not too worried. Now, Larry, you want to know whether or not we could see an elephant today. We might. It's entirely possible. So all of these animals are completely wild. So it's not like traveling around a zoo and first you go to the elephants and then you go to the lions. Sometimes we have to work and see and try and find them. And these animals can walk long, long distances. So there might be some elephants around. There might not be. I'll look for some fresh signs, some fresh footprints in the soil, and some fresh dung to see whether or not there are any elephants in the area. But we're going to look for all sorts of exciting things. Now, just off to my left is a waterhole, and actually, I want to show you something. Sorry, we're going to go back onto a road because that's where the track is clearest. But I want to show you why we're going to be very, very careful around this waterhole. And Elena, speaking of waterholes, you wanted to know how big the waterhole is and how many are needed to keep the animals alive. Well, Elena, we've got two pumped water holes around the lodge. In other words, there's a pump that brings water up from underground that gives the animals water, and that's because we've been in such a bad drought. But we've got quite a few. We need lots and lots of big water holes in order to keep lots of animals with enough water to survive. I'm just looking for this particular animal's tracks. And in fact, there's two animals here that we might want to avoid. I want to be very careful when we go across this waterhole. Where's his tracks gone? I'm going to draw them for you, but I saw them earlier, and I can see he's gone straight back to his watering hole. There's an animal living in the waterhole that has a giant footprint that looks like this. Yeah. Sort of. I'm not the best artist in the world, but there is a very big animal with a foot almost that big and four toes that at the moment is sheltering from this hot, hot day in the waterhole just a few hundred meters away, and that is a hippopotamus. So that footprint that I've drawn is what a hippopotamus track looks like. We're being very careful around some of the animals at the moment because, you know, we've spoken about the fact that it has been drought season. There's very, very little water left in that pan, in that waterhole. So that poor hippo doesn't have very much space. He doesn't feel very safe. He actually feels a little bit scared about all that's happening and the fact that he doesn't have much water. And because he's scared, we have to be extra careful because hippo can be very dangerous. Now, Eli, while we're here with my very badly drawn hippo track, you want to know how big an elephant track is. Well, of course, it depends on the size of the elephant, but a big male elephant, their track is, let's say this, let me wipe out my hippo track. A big male elephant track is easily this big. And their front tracks are nice and round. So a big elephant track, and I've tried this before, when I see a big male elephant's track, I can actually climb inside of it. Not right inside of it, I don't sink down, but I can actually fit. If I curl myself up, I can fit into a big male elephant's tracks. But then you get baby elephants as well. And baby elephants, of course, will have much, much smaller tracks. So a baby elephant's track might only be this big. The nice thing about an elephant track, of course, is that the way that the track is shaped will actually tell you which way the elephant is going. So their back foot, their front foot is nice and round, but their back foot has a point at the end of it. So it's shaped almost like a teardrop. And that point shows you which way the elephant is going. So this elephant would be going that way, if this was a real track, but of course now I am drawing tracks. Now, there are lots and lots of different creatures out here, and it sounds like Byron has found one of my favorites to show you.
Look at this, and this is one of Jamie's favorite animals, and I must admit, one of mine too, a beautiful warthog. Now, some people might laugh at me for calling it beautiful. I'm going to try to roll forward a little bit so you can see its face. Let's have a look. Hold on. And they are strange-looking creatures, the warthogs. And look how interesting this is. Look how it's busy feeding. Can you see it goes down on its knees, on its front knees, so that it can actually get down lower to the ground and eat the grass. The warthogs only eat grass, sometimes little shoots or roots that they dig up with their noses, but they do prefer feeding on the little grass roots and shoots, and that we can see over there. And look at those big tusks. Now this is a big male, and I can tell that just by looking at his face. Can you see he's got two warts on the side of his face over there, and two on the other side. Now the males have got four warts, and the females only have two. So you can tell very easily if it's a male or female just by looking at the face. Look at those big tusks. Now, those big tusks are why the warthog have got those warts, and it's to protect their face when they do fight against one another, especially the males. And again, just like the impala, they will fight because they want to chase off any competition, any other males that are in their territory. Oh, Tyler, you asked how much do warthogs weigh. So big warthogs, very, very big warthogs, can get up to about 80 or 100 kilograms. Now, if I'm not mistaken, I think that's an 80 kilogram warthog could be about 180 pounds, 180 to 200 pounds. So it's very, very heavy. And some of them can get much bigger than that. But that would be a very big warthog, a very old warthog. One this size, I'm not sure. Maybe about 40 or 50 kilograms, which is probably around 130 pounds, somewhere around there, 140 pounds. Now, Caden, if you have a look closely at this warthog, it doesn't look like it's washed itself in ages. Look at the mud on the body. Can you see that? Now, what these warthogs love to do is they like to roll around in the mud and in the little water holes where there's lots of mud. They prefer doing that, so they don't really wash themselves. They're trying to get a lot of mud on their bodies. And the reason for that is because it protects their skin, helps keep them cool, and it can also help protect them from insects like ticks or flies that sometimes sit on their bodies. So it helps keep those little insects away. So that warthog's actually dirty. He's not very clean. Lexi, I love your question. You want to know why do they have such a big body and such a small tail? I don't know, Lexi. I don't know. Apparently, I'm trying to think. There's an old folk tale about, and a folk tale is a story that was told to children when they were younger. It doesn't mean it was true. And there's an old folk tale that goes on about the warthog and how it got its tail. And I can't remember now which animal it got swapped with, and it could have been a hippopotamus or something. I can't remember, but the warthog and this other animal, I think it may have been one of the antelope, actually, that had a much bushier tail, perhaps an Inyala. The Inyala was meant to get a little tail, and the Wartog was meant to get the big bushy tail, and then they actually got swapped in the line when the tails were being handed out, and they got swapped around, and the Wartog ended up with the little tail, and the Inyala got a big bushy tail. But that's just a story. I don't know why it's got such a small tail. Probably because it doesn't need a big tail. And Jaden, the Wartogs eat so much grass because that's what they feed on. That's the food that keeps them big and strong. So they have to eat a lot of grass because you can imagine. Think about us, for example. If we only ate salad, we wouldn't necessarily be very big and strong, would we? We'd have to eat a lot of salad, or we'd have to eat some other food too. So the Wartogs, because they only eat grass, they need to eat a lot of it to grow and become big and strong. I'm going to try and move forward a little bit further. This Wartog seemed very relaxed with us, which is wonderful. Oh, this is such a lovely treat, everyone. Look at him. He's a nice big male. There you can see his face clearly. Vaden, you want to know what family is the Wartog part of? And that's a good question, Vaden. They're part of the pig family, actually. So you sometimes get, and I think in America, you get wild boar. This is very similar. It's part of that pig family, the wild pig family. And I wonder if he'll run for us. I don't want to chase him, but there is something interesting that they do when they do run. But he's not worried about us at all, so he's not running. He's just looking for some shade now, it looks like. Let's see if he lies down. Let's just wait a little bit and see if he does decide to lie down or if he's going to move on. Elia, I think that's how you pronounce your name, Elia. You wanted to know, what would the Wartog do if I got very close to it? Well, if I got very close, the Wartog would do one of two things. It would most likely choose to run away from me, because I'm a little bit taller, bigger, and it would look like I am a predator, so the Wartog would rather choose to run away. However, if I did threaten it quite a bit and it got a fright, it may decide to charge me, and with those big tusks, look at that, they can do some serious damage to me, so I wouldn't like to test it, because these Wartogs are very strong, and if they run at me with those big tusks, they can do some serious damage. And little Riley, you want to know if the boy and girl Wartogs have horns? They do indeed, but they're not horns. They are called tusks. So it's actually like a tooth that the Wartogs have. So it's an extension of a tooth, and it's not actually a horn. So now that both male and female have tusks, and the main reason is to protect themselves. And the males also use them, obviously, when they're fighting against one another. But the main reason is to protect themselves from predators. So if something tries to attack them, they can use those sharp tusks to potentially harm whatever it is that's trying to hunt them or kill them. Oh, what a wonderful sighting. It looks like he's going to walk off now. And really, really so lucky that we got to see him. A really fantastic sighting. We're going to head back to Jamie, who's walking, and see what she has found for us.
Oh, Byron is absolutely right. We are so lucky to see things like warthog. Remember how I said that out here on foot, it's one of the best ways for us to see the littler creatures and the littler things out here. And just have a look at this incredible web that you see in front of you. It is a massive, messy spider's web. And I don't want to touch it, I don't want to break it too much. It's very, very sticky. Now, this particular spider's web is known as a funnel web spider. Now, it's not like some of the more dangerous funnel web spiders. I know in certain areas of the world, a funnel web is a very, very venomous spider. This spider isn't terribly dangerous at all. And it's called a funnel web, not because of this messy nest outside, but because it actually makes, and it's very difficult for us to show you, but it actually makes itself a little funnel that goes down towards the ground over there. So there is his funnel. That's where the spider is actually hiding. He's hiding in that little tunnel of silk. Our spider silk is the most amazing substance. It's one of the strongest things in the world. If I were to take lots and lots of the spider web all together and I were to make it into a thick strand, maybe as thick as two of my fingers combined, if we were to make it, imagine making it into a long rope, that would be strong enough to stop a car and possibly even an aeroplane. That's how strong spider silk really is. And it's amazing that the spiders can make it with their bodies. Now, this particular funnel web lives in his funnel until he hears the sound of something plucking gently on the strings of the web, at which point he will come out, or she will come out, to see and investigate and see what it is. And sometimes you find other little spiders in this web as well, little spiders that are looking for a free meal. They're known as kleptoparasites. In other words, they steal food from other spiders, and sometimes you find them in these webs. Unfortunately, or fortunately, I suppose, for this funnel web spider, it seems as though his home security is good and he doesn't have to worry about any intruders. Right, let's see what other things we can find. Now, Braden, you wanted to know what is the most poisonous spider, and I'm sorry, my leg just went dead. It's gone all pins and needles. Must be in the way that I was crouching. Our most poisonous spider, well, actually, we can't call it poisonous. Poisonous is dangerous. Poison is dangerous when you eat it. Something venomous is venomous when it bites you or it stings you. So a spider is not necessarily poisonous, because you could probably eat it. I wouldn't advise it, but you could probably eat it. And a snake's not really poisonous either. But if it bites you or it stings you, then that makes it venomous. And our most venomous spiders are known as the widow spiders. And some of you will be familiar. It's the sort of the cousin of the recluse spider. There's quite a few different types. In our area, our ones don't have the clearest red markings, but they do sometimes on their abdomens in the shape of an hourglass, bright red hourglass. And it's something that you might be familiar with. Perhaps you've heard of recluse spiders. And they're okay. Most of the time, if you get bitten by them, you'll probably be absolutely fine. But you should maybe go to a doctor, especially for young people and for older people, that their venom is slightly more effective. And you start to feel very anxious and very scared, but you go to a doctor and they will be able to treat it just fine. Then we also get a type of spider out here that is called a sac spider. And a sac spider does something different. A sac spider, and I'm looking to see if I can't find you another spider example. A sac spider has what's called cytotoxic venom. So when it bites you, it gets a really nasty infection. Sac spider or a violin spider. And then you've got to go to the doctor and you've got to have some antibiotics, and you've got to make sure that you look after it and keep it really, really clean, because the venom essentially attacks your flesh. It attacks your tissue and it makes a very, very sore wound. Now, some of the spiders, of course, like the funnel webs, are on the ground. Missy, you wanted to know, why do they make their webs out in the open? Well, it just depends upon the spider that you're talking about. Some of them have a massive webs that stretch across a whole load of trees and branches, whilst others have nests and spider webs that are completely hidden. So what I'm looking for, Missy, is I'm looking for a nice piece of fallen bark, and I don't think I see any. But let's try. We're going to try and have to creep through here for a second. So everybody squeeze in behind me. I'm going to try and... Can you squeeze through here, Jandre? No. We might... Jandre's got to duck under. And then we're going to come through here. And let's see if we can't find a nice spiderweb for you, Missy, hidden away under a log. Nope, no spiders hiding there. Now, Spicato, you wanted to know whether or not all of the spiders lay eggs. Yes, they do. All of the spiders will lay eggs. They lay eggs in different places, much like some spiders have their webs out in the open and some are hidden beneath logs. Absolutely, they will lay eggs in different places. And we're seeing a lot of mysterious eggs that we don't necessarily know what they are. Reptile eggs. I saw some bird eggs earlier. Spider eggs are generally hidden away beneath the folds of trees. Hold on a second, I want to just try and show you something. Where did you go? I just saw you. No, that's ridiculous. I promise you I just saw this creature. I just saw something called a velvet ant. But now all I can see is real ants. And the velvet ant is hidden. Huh. I wanted to show it to you. What a pity. Now, Dylan, you want to know what is the biggest spider in our area. I'll look and see if I can't find you the tunnel of a baboon spider. A baboon spider is the South African equivalent of a tarantula. So a baboon spider is a spider that can get almost as big as my hand. Big, hairy spider. They're my favorite spiders. I find them fascinating. They're not dangerous to people at all. But a baboon spider is the size of my hand. So that's how big they are. That's our biggest spider. And you get different types of them. I wish I could find you that velvet ant, but it's disappeared. But instead, we can perhaps talk about this fascinating little thing. Now this might just look like it is a hole in the ground, and it's not. It is a home of a very interesting creature, and it's a home of a creature called an antlion. The reason an antlion is called an antlion is because it is much sort of the size of a very large ant, but it's called a lion because it's got these sharp, sharp jaws that are capable of catching and grabbing ants. And what they do is they dig themselves down. Ooh, careful ant. That little ant nearly ran in there. They dig themselves into these little pits. And then when an ant comes and crawls along the edges, just the lightest touch. When an ant crawls along the edges, they disturb the soil and they start to fall. So imagine an ant slipping down into the center of this pit. And as soon as the ant falls down into the center of the pit, the antlion bursts out and grabs it and then pulls it down and eats it. So that's called an antlion larvae. And when it's big, when it's fully grown, it'll grow up into a massive, almost like a dragonfly, a really, really beautiful dragonfly. But that can take, for some antlions, that can take up to 12 years that they can live in these little pits until they are ready to turn into an antlion. Now, Carson, you wanted to know how many different types of venomous spiders there are in Africa. Carson, there are the black widow, the brown widow, the sack spider, and the violin spider, and the crab spider, and the... Did I say violin spider? I didn't say violin spider. So there's five of them that are incredibly important in terms of you need to go and see a doctor if you get bitten by them. There are other types of spiders that are venomous, but it doesn't really affect you in any way. So it affects their prey because their prey is small, but for humans, it's not dangerous at all. So there's lots of different types of venomous spiders, but there's only really five or six that are dangerous to people. Not even very dangerous, dangerous to people. And that's only if you don't treat them well. This is a good one. This is a nice pit here. Nice antlion pit here. Our Samantha, I'm just going to see if I can't show you at least it digging out the sand so I can prove to you that there's something living in here. Samantha, you wanted to know what forms of defense spiders have. One of their big defense mechanisms is being, a lot of them are very, very camouflaged. Oh, he doesn't want to play with us this afternoon. He doesn't want to show himself. So a lot of the spiders are beautifully hidden. They're coloured like bark, or else they live deep beneath the surface of the soil, perhaps only coming out at night, hiding under the surface of leaves, hiding away, sheltered by their web. They've got lots of defence mechanisms. Most of them don't really fight back. If they're being attacked, they try and run away. And some of them are very, very quick. You even get spiders like a jumping spider that suddenly jumps out of the way and moves from place to place by jumping. What other defense? The only spider that will fight by biting is a, properly fight by biting, is a baboon spider. So while we go off in search of spiders, scorpions and other such things, Brent's got the right idea on this hot afternoon. Let's go and see what's happening at the waterhole.
Well, we're way down in the eastern side of our traverse area, and we've come up across a small herd of buffalo that are coming down to drink. They're still looking incredibly skinny. We've just gone through the worst drought in 100 years, but they'll be very happy to quench their thirst on this hot, hot day. And hopefully there'll be a bit more rain soon and the grass will get a bit better for them. See those massive horns? That's a male. And then not so massive horns on a female. Not too many of them. Sometimes we get herds of up to 600, but with the drought they seem to have split into smaller groups. Probably about 30 here. Now Reagan's wondering, do we see any birds in this area? We see lots of birds, Reagan. And there's even a bird that lives on the buffalo, on the far right buffalo of him, in the middle of his back. There's, oh, there it flew off. He's gonna go have a drink. There we go, there's some more. Those are called oxpeckers, Reagan. And they eat ticks. And there's another bird called a blacksmith lapwing. He likes to live around the water and he eats little aquatic insects. Now, quite often when buffalo approach water, they can be quite nervous because over the last couple of months with being so dry, the lions have been waiting for them around water holes. So it always pays to be careful when coming for a drink, because you never know. Oh, Vim, the oxpeckers are bathing up on the inlet there. Oh, look at that. Even the birds are cooling off. It's so hot. He's having a nice bath. Now, Michael's wondering, are there any alligators that might eat the buffalo or the birds? Well, no, they're not in this particular pan, but they could be at a different time. So we don't get alligators, we get crocodiles. And they do move from waterhole to waterhole. At the moment, I'd say this is too little water for a crocodile, but if we get more rain, and then the crocodile might move back here. Now Missy's wondering, do the buffalo go all the way into the water? Yes, Missy, sometimes they do. I've even seen a buffalo swim and go all completely under the water. There's not much water here, so I don't think they're going to do that today. And at the moment, they're more worried about finding good grass. So they'll drink a little bit and then they'll move off to try go find some grazing. Now, even though they look like cows, they're not that closely related to cows at all. And they've separate species completely. Nate would like to know how many types of buffalo in the area. Only one, Nate. Oh, we've just got a strange noise coming from our car all of a sudden. Do you hear that, Vim? What is that? Okay, well, it's stopped now. Well, Nate, you only get one kind of buffalo here. It's called the Cape buffalo. Further up in Africa, you get forest buffalo, but those are the only two buffalo species we get in Africa. Lydia's wondering, are there any other fish or other animals in that waterhole? There will be lots of little insects, Lydia. At the moment, probably no fish. Oh, look at that buffalo having a scratch, trying to get rid of all the ticks and fleas and biting insects and arachnids that are on them. And you can see how polished that log is. That's not the first time a buffalo has had a scratch on that log. Now, they will have favorite scratching spots near water holes, and you won't be the only animal that'll use it. You'll probably find that elephants might use it, as well as maybe even rhino. Garrett would like to know why the horns are in the shape of a moustache. Well, it's a very good design if you have to fight. So those hooked horns facing forward with the big thick area in the middle, that gives them protection if they bash their heads together while they fight for girlfriends. And it's also very good at keeping lions away. Jaden, you are 100% correct. The birds that we saw on the back of those buffalo, they eat ticks off the buffalo, as well as other parasites. Now, Clark's wondering what happens if we disturb the buffalo or get too close. Normally, Clark, they'll just run away, but we don't want to disturb them. As you can see, they're not looking very healthy. They're still very skinny from not having enough food over this dry season. It was very, very dry, so they're slowly recovering. We don't want to disturb the animals ever, but sometimes they can chase you or get aggressive if you do disturb them, especially when they're ill or sick or hungry like these ones are. Here we go. Well, the buffalo are going to move off. I got a report of a male leopard in this area, so we're going to keep looking. But Jasmine says, do the buffalo stay in a group? And normally they do. They stay in herds. As I said, you can get herds of up to 600 in this area. There are only about 30 or so in that one. But and the only time they really get split from their groups or their herds is when they get chased by lions. Now, they might move herds or change groups when two groups converge, but that's normal. But they try to stay together because it's much safer in a big group than by yourself, because the lions will get you. Okay, so we got a report that this male leopard moved into this bush around here, and this particular male leopard likes to sit in trees quite a lot, especially when it's hot. So we're just going to go very slowly. We're going to keep checking up high. Maybe we'll spot him snoozing in a tree. Wouldn't that be fun? Now, of course, we're looking for leopards, we looked at some buffalo, but there are some incredibly beautiful birds around here as well. And there's one, Vim. Have you got him? There we go. Here we go. That is a European bee eater. Now, he likes to eat bees and wasps and things with stings. But how he does that is he catches them, but before he eats them, he beats them up on a branch so they can't hurt him. And he travels a long way. So he's one of the migrant species. So he comes all the way from Europe, from France and Spain, and he travels many thousands of miles to come and feed on all the insects in our summer month here. Let's see if we can go. Off he goes. Ooh, VM spotted something. Now, VM spotted something we don't see too often. It's called a slender mongoose. It's one of the predatory mongoose. I'm gonna try and get, I didn't see it, so I'm just gonna move forward a little bit. Where do you think he is, VMP? Right behind these bushes. It might be a squirrel. Well, let's hope it's not a squirrel. Let's hope it's a mongoose. Oh, there he is, there he is. It is a mongoose. Well spotted, VM. Oh, that's so cool. They normally run away very quickly, just like that. Oh, well, well done, VM. Great spot. Isn't that awesome? Now, these are really good little hunters. Eat lots of different things, like the things Jamie was looking for, spiders and scorpions. But it's been wonderful. Windsor Woods, Creeds, and Trantwood Elementary, great to have you on the back of the Game Drive vehicle with us. Hopefully, you'll be joining us again soon. But from myself, Byron, Jamie, and the whole Safari Live team, bye!
And look at this, everyone. We've managed to find one of the big Nkuhuma males, a big coalition that patrol through this entire territory. And this is one of the males that I think the same male Jamie had this morning. It doesn't look as if he's moved too far from where she had him. He has moved into the shade a bit. And he's panting very heavily because it is so hot. And he's very clever. He's the only one that's got shade at the moment. We out in the open. But I don't think this lion is going to move anytime soon. If anything, he may just try and move further into the shade. And that's exactly what he's doing. That's exactly what he's doing there. He's just moved a little bit further into the shade. But I don't think he's going to get up and move anytime soon. I mean, I could be wrong. But it looks like he'd preferably stay in the shade there. I mean, the interesting thing is there's lovely shade just behind him. If you have a look around this area, there's some lovely shade under those trees off to the left. But he's being a bit stubborn, it appears. Staying in that little area where he is. I don't think we're going to stay with this lion for too long. I'll tell you why. It's because it is very warm and I don't think he's going to move. If anything, I think he'll possibly just try and move into the shade around here. Let's see if he does get up. He's changing positions a little bit, but it doesn't look like he's really interested. I mean, who knows? You never know. You never know, because these animals always do exactly what they want. There's no telling what they're going to do. But it's so great to see one of these big males. I'm thinking that our plan should probably be to carry on and see what else we can find in this area on Arethusa this afternoon. And while we are in this area, we'll possibly come back later and see what this male gets up to. Maybe get him when he decides to wake up and possibly roar. Wouldn't that be wonderful? Yeah, it's very, very warm. So I think, why don't we head out of this area and continue on and see what we can find. Maybe go and check some of the water holes or dams in this area. Because it's so hot, perhaps we're fortunate and we get some animals going down to drink. That would be great. Let's just see. Hang on, there we go. Let's see if he does decide to move into shade. Or is he just changing positions? Just changing positions. That's a very, very hot lion. And there he goes. All right, I think that's what we're going to do now. We are going to move on. And Tanis, you'd like to see a European roller and you'd ask if we can find you one. I will do my best. Let's see, and while we're driving around, we'll definitely do some birding. what a wonderful sighting of that male, though. At least we know where he is for later. Okay, I'm going to head out of this area and head towards some waterholes. Let's head back to Jamie on her walk and see what she's got up to.
That is something that we think is a possibility in terms of Karula moving around, that perhaps she might be doing as well, going to have a drink perhaps around Galigopan. So Rexon finally managed to find where her tracks crossed over the road, though apparently it was very, very difficult to see, and she's made her way in that direction, and that's about as accurate as we can get. I don't know if this is going to work. I want to show you... No. There's grasshopper that doesn't want to be seen. Okay, well, one of the things I wanted to show you was what we know, what we term pans. And I know that Steph has discussed these in great length before, at great length before. Now, unfortunately, they've all completely, or most of them, have dried up. Treehouse Dam, Buffelzoek Dam, these are the only places, really, that have any water left. But this wallow would actually have been made by the animals themselves. So it would have started out as a little depression in the earth, a little bit of a seep line with the water moving towards Treehouse Dam, started off as a puddle, and then a warthog. And I'm looking to see if I can find your warthog tracks. A warthog would have come along and had a jolly good mud wallow, and it would have got slightly bigger. And then a big buffalo bull would have come and flopped down into it and made it even bigger. And then elephants would have come and started excavating and digging and splashing in the water. And that in turn would have created this relatively large sized pan that we've got here. And in a typical rainy season, this would be full. This would be full right up to this sort of level. And we've seen these pans full before. And this would actually be a place to try and avoid when you're on walk. Not necessarily avoid, just be very careful as you approach it. Because it would be the sort of place that a buffalo would absolutely love to be wallowing in. Buffalo spend a great deal, particularly the big old male buffaloes. That's why they're called dugger boys, mud boys. They spend most of their summer afternoons wallowing in patches exactly like this. So it would be, it's why it's so nice to get to know a different area, so that you can actually get a chance to see all of these areas. Now, Jay, you wanted to know if the rains doesn't come, or if the rains don't come, and all of the buffalo died, would buffalo come from the other parts of the reserve? It's unlikely that all of the buffalo would die. If we're in a situation where all a couple of thousands of buffalo have died, we're in a really, really serious situation. It's, I suppose it's possible, but then it's not just going to be the buffalo, it's going to be all sorts of other things. So chances are not all of the buffalo will die, even if the rains don't come initially. What they'll do is they'll probably disperse to areas where there has been better rain. But yes, the animals can and do... Go away, flies. There are so many biting flies around us. The animals can and do move between areas, and they move where the food is better, where there's been a little bit more rain. The buffalo up to the north of us, in the north of Kruger, have had much better time of things. They're actually not nearly... They weren't. I don't know how things are now. But a month or two ago, they weren't having nearly as difficult a time of it as our buffalo were. There's one thing I've noticed recently. I actually don't even know when I last saw a buffalo. Jandre, when last did you see a buffalo?
Four duggers last night.
Saw about four dugger boys last night, apparently. I did not. I have not seen a buffalo in a long time. And we're slowly but surely making our way through this vegetation, just in case we happen to encounter Karula. She might have caught and killed something during the course of the day. The one thing that we have to our advantage is the heat of this afternoon. So on a day like today, although leopards are funny things, a big cat like a lion, not going to really do anything when it's this hot. A leopard, on the other hand, we've seen even Tingana has moved through an area when it's 40 degrees centigrade, so over 100 Fahrenheit. So it's difficult to judge exactly what the animals are going to do. Sorry, been attracted by these shards of what was almost certainly a giant land snail shell that has been stomped on. Tony, you want to know if the ground gets hot like beach sand here? Yes, it does. And on a day like today, look, it's not the hottest day we've had in a while, but it does feel as though the earth is sort of exuding this massive heat. And absolutely, the sand, particularly the redder sands, get very, very hot underfoot. And of course, ow! So Sorry, I resented that bite. I'm not even sure I got it after all of that since sound and fuss. In terms of walking around, we walk around barefoot all the time, and we find ourselves with very, very hot feet. So yes, the ground does get hot, like beach sand. This massive termite mound. It's amazing to think of just how many years and years and years the termites took to build it. It is phenomenally big. Right. Apparently, in case you're wondering what's happening with the other vehicles, they are struggling with comms and signal right now. So you're on the bushwalk with us for now, and we will see what we can find you. I'm just checking all of the hollows of these trees. I might have been a little too bold in my approach, though, because generally little reptiles and skinks, something that might live in these hollows, or snakes, might live in here. They probably would have moved off at the rapid... due to the rapid nature of my approach. Oh, that's interesting. First of all, a whole load of flies came out. It's not often we get to see is this a marula seed? Uh-huh. Looks odd. It doesn't actually look like a marula seed. Obviously it looks, that's the squirrel eating inside of it, and we see this all the time with our marula seeds. But the shape of this is just ever so slightly off. Maybe it wasn't a ripe one. It has to be a marula seed, though, because there are a whole load of them on the ground. But it's interesting, we don't often get to see this casing around the edge of it. It must be a marula seed. So what happens is the squirrels come with their long, sort of sharp teeth, and they break open the... get into the center, or the kernel, of these marula seeds, and they get to the, obviously, the very nutritious... it's sort of food storage system that a seed has. And just hold on one moment, I'm just going to check and see. You hear hooves. Could well be in Yala or Impala. Let me know if you see a large buffalo behind me. Otherwise I think we're okay. That's a more typical marula. That would be more like what we are used to seeing. You can see it's completely without the peel, without the husk around the seed. Sorry, there's a biting fly behind my knee. Sorry, Chandra, I know you were trying to. But it was crawling at the back of my knee. It was the worst, most ticklish spot possible. I'm going to take this. Now, all of these marula seeds concentrated at the base of what is not a marula tree. This is not a marula tree. You can see immediately from the bark. And it looks like it's a monkey thorn. So it's a monkey thorn tree, not a marula tree. So, what does that tell us? The fact that we've got a whole load of marula seeds gathered underneath a monkey thorn tree tells us that there is a squirrel living somewhere in this tree. This is a squirrel's food cache that they've had at the bottom of the tree here. They don't obviously collect food for winter in the same way that squirrels in European areas might do, because they don't hibernate. But they will probably actually gather food below the level of their trees. I'm trying to see, you can usually, this must be the marula it came from. Yep, this is the marula tree that these marula seeds would have come from, and they would have been carried there by a squirrel. And there you go, one mystery solved. On to the next. In the meantime, while we go and search for more mysteries to unfold and uncover, let's go across to Byron, who is on Arethusa.
And we are busy driving around, having a look for some birds and any animal activity, but it's very, very warm at the moment. Ooh, a little steenbok, let's see if it stops. Straight ahead. No, very, very shy, very, very shy. And I understand Jamie was being attacked by little biting flies. And it's so funny because Jamie asked me the other day why the flies were biting me so much. Because a few times in a sighting I was getting bitten by these little flies. It's quite sore. So I do feel sorry for Jamie. Speaking of bites, I've got itchy, very itchy tick bites from all the walking too. Yeah, it's not fun. I haven't seen too many other animals around at the moment in this area, but it's too soon to panic. We'll always have a look around and see what we can find. Oh, is there, what bird is up there? Is it a grey go-away bird? Looks like it. It is indeed trying to hide from us. Or trying to hide from the heat, actually, not from us. Oh, look at that. A beautiful grey go-away bird. I wonder if it's going to call for us. Trying to hold on in the wind and then also stay in the shade because of the heat. You could see it was sitting with its beak open earlier, and that's how some of these birds try to stay cool. There, it's doing it now. It's got its beak open, and it's known as gular flatter. So they've got a gular flap inside the mouth. And what happens is with the wind blowing over and through the beak, it helps cool the body down. Isn't that interesting? Now they've got that wonderful call and grrr, grrr, grrr. That's the sound of the grey go-away bird, I think. Not very good at it, but grey go-away bird. Oh, that's lovely. Wasn't that fantastic? Nice to see that bird. And I know we are looking for a European roller. That would be nice. Nothing just yet. It's nice when you do stop and you just scan around for a little bit. Have a look if you can't see any birds. Interesting little... sorry everyone, I made a bit of a mistake earlier. Seeing the Nkuruma pride all the time, I called the male lion that we just saw. I said he was one of the Nkuruma males. He's the father of the Nkuruma cubs, but he's not an Nkuruma male. He's one of the Birmingham males, and some of our viewers have said it was Ntinyo that we saw over there. Oh, what little bird is that? Oh, it's gone. And that's a trouble with birding while you're driving around, is a lot of these little birds move around very, very quickly, and it's tough to keep up with them. So one of the Birmingham males. Oh, there's a magpie shrike. Let's see if we can have a look at that. There we go. Also... just up at the top of that tree now. Can you see that hat right back? There we go. Balancing, using that tail to balance. They are beautiful, beautiful birds. The magpie shrike. Beautiful black and white with that long tail. Also, sitting with its beak open. Let's see if it turns its head again. There, do you see that? Again, trying to stay cool. See how many bird species do it. It's very, very interesting. And here's another little bird about to cross the road. Just off to the left, a little crested Franklin. Two of them. Just off to the side, sorry, in the little thicket, there's two or three. There's one, there we go. And there's another one just to the left of that. There we go. the crested Franklin, crested spurfowl, I think is the name that it's currently got. No, it's actually still called the Franklin. I get a bit confused sometimes with some of these Franklins and Spurfowls, which names changed and which stayed the same. So this is still the Franklin, the crested Franklin. Beautiful little ground birds. And we also saw the Koki Franklin this morning, which is really nice. There's a little Franklin that we don't always see. So nice to see these crested Franklins around. They do generally make quite a noise. It's very peaceful sitting watching these birds forage for little seeds and that in the scrub. Oh, it's actually coming out across the road. But look, also beak open, trying to cool down, doing that gular flutter. Very interesting behavior from the birds. It's nice to see this different behavior from all the bird species. And just shows you how hot it is out here at the moment and how the animals adapt to keeping cool. Well, let's see what other birds we can find around here. And I'm hoping, again, still if we can try find some elephant this afternoon, that would be wonderful. I do miss the elephant. I haven't seen him for, and I keep saying this, but I haven't seen elephant for about a week. So hopefully we get to see some elephant soon. Oh, there's a very pungent smell in the air. Oh, strong. Is there a carcass here somewhere? There must be. There we go. There's one off to the left. That's what smells like that. Another buffalo carcass in there. Plenty of buffalo carcasses around, and we know that because I think the main reason is because of the drought. It really did affect these buffalo quite a bit. Sorry, just got a big whiff of the smell. Oh, look at that. Oh, beautiful butterfly. Beautiful butterfly just flew past us. Unfortunately, couldn't show it to you. It was a citrus swallowtail. Anyway, let's continue our search for elephant. That's our plan this afternoon. We'll try to find some elephant, and while I do that, let's head back to Brent and get an update from him.
Well, we're still continuing our search for quarantine, checking in all the tall trees. I've come to a high point here where I can use my binoculars and just scan, hoping to see a tail or a leg hanging out of a big marula or jackalberry tree. We're right in the sort of northeastern corner. We're going to check down towards the Kruger boundary now. But so far, no luck. He could just be sleeping flat somewhere in those thickets around that drainage line. And with this heat today, that friendly cloud went over us, so now we're back in the sunshine. It's unlikely that he's going to move too much. I just want to check, there's that lovely little section below Buff Pan on the little river system there. It's got lovely trees, shade, some cool sand possibly. But other than that and those very skinny buffalo, we have seen absolutely nothing down here. Now, if we don't get rain soon, I mean, this grass is being burnt by the sun. You can see it's losing color and dying already. And I tell you what, there's not much shade for us out here either. Now, I'm thinking if I'm quarantined, I'm going to be looking for shade. Deep, dark, wonderful shade. So that's why we're checking around the little river systems, those bigger trees, and a better chance of having a good bit of shade to snooze in. I can't get hold of the guys from Nkoro and to find out exactly where he crossed and what time. I will keep trying though. Okay. Ah, there we go. So we have just arrived down here. Now, let's have a look here. There's big termite mounds, jackalberry trees. If you're a leopard, this is a good spot. There's a lovely little bend in the river here that's got lots of shade, and the sand should have been protected from the heat of the day, the sun for the majority of the day, so it could be quite cool, a good spot to have a snooze. Oh, he's not there though. Has he crossed into Kruger? I don't think so. We haven't seen any tracks or sign of him heading towards Kruger. Well, we're on the boundary now. Let's just have a quick squiz, and this is another good spot. Nice big termite mound, lots of shade. It's a little bit of water. It was a little bit of water. It's all dried up. So, oh, not here. Okay, let's head back towards Buff Pan. Quarantines are very big for a young male leopard of his age, and he's been showing some very interesting behavior in his sort of, he's almost pushing Shivambalan, his older half-brother, out into the Kruger and taking over his territory. Now, of course, he's still a threat to Nkanyeni's cub or cubs. I'm not sure how many she's got at the moment. I think she's still got two. And I thought I heard a squirrel, but it wasn't. And so it's very interesting. Now, being so big, he can possibly, I mean, he is not possibly, he is definitely challenging for an area at a much younger age. And I'm quite happy because I really do love that leopard, and it'll be wonderful to see him more regularly down here on Cheetah Plains. But first things first, let's try find him today. Remember, we're on a completely live interactive safari in the middle of the African bush, and you can ask us questions by using the hashtag SafariLive or use the email address questions@wildearth.tv. Now, we're going to have one last little dabble through towards Buff Pan, which is now Buff Dam. I think it's going to be quite beautiful once it fills up with rainwater, as they've dug it out quite deep and created some islands, so it could become quite a special little spot. Hello, S Espen. Espen would like to know, what kind of fish live in the reserve? Well, up here, where we're not on any permanent rivers, generally the most common is the sharp-toothed catfish. And they actually are able to walk over land. So, and if water dries out, you can actually find them walking through the middle of the bush. I normally do it at night when it's quite cool. So, okay, so there, and then also tilapia are indigenous to this area, and then once you get onto the permanent rivers that are flowing, you get yellowfish, which is a type of barb, and lots of little catlets, libeos, and even small tigerfish in the Sabi and the Sand River. Okay, so he crossed somewhere around here. Now we've checked all the nice big trees and there's no sign of him snoozing in there. I'm wondering if he hasn't just snuck back to one of his favorite haunts, the three in a row pan. So while we're gonna make our way back towards there, and maybe we'll find him there. That would be lovely. I really, really hope we find him. I absolutely adore spending time with that leopard. It's also one of my favorite leopards to photograph. And Vim, one of your favorite to film?
Yeah, I do quarantine.
Yeah, Vim digs quarantine now, we all do. And one of the leopards I got to spend a lot of time with when I first started at Safari Live. Him and his brother, Kunyuma, who was my favorite, but don't tell quarantine, Mr. Snarly Face, but he seems to be quite happily settled down south in Londolozi at the moment. Okay, so from the information, he could have crossed anywhere where we're driving now. Now he could have just gone flat in one of these areas, but I can't see the tracks. There's been a big tractor down here doing road maintenance. So I think we're gonna check Owl's Nest Road back towards Three in a Row Pan. We keep checking for the normally relatively easy to find, but being tricky today, Mr. Quarantine, Jamie has got a creeping and crawling and maybe even a hairy thing to show you.
Oh, I really do hope that Brent manages to see Quarantine. He is definitely one of the most beautiful leopards that we see out here. In the meantime, Jandre and myself have found something, I suppose, beautiful in their own right, but definitely an answer to the mystery that I've been pondering over the last few days. Now, while I've been walking, one of the things, of course, that you notice more clearly when you're on foot than when you are on a vehicle is the damage that has been done to various species of trees. Sorry, it was a pugnacious ant. It was a Bernie bite. Luckily my caterpillar stayed on. Now one's bitten me. I didn't squash it though, so it shouldn't get the rest of them to attack me. What was that doing to you, you horrible thing? Moving on. So there we have the answer to what's been eating our silver cluster leaf. And looking at this tree, they are absolutely everywhere. I wish they ate ants. They're absolutely everywhere. And what they're doing is they've finished off almost all of the leaves of this tree. And they're now all jettisoning off in different directions. And they are crawling all about the bottom. I've got to be so careful, Jandre and myself, where we step. Oh, this one's lost his nerve. One of them did just jump off that end. Not jump. I'm not sure caterpillars really jump. It was more of a fall down onto the ground. But the more I look, the more I see of them. They're absolutely everywhere. This one's slowly but surely making his way along. I've got a friend here that I've collected, so now the mystery is just which caterpillar is it? And why are they targeting the silver cluster leaves? Where have they hatched from? It's very common for us to see caterpillar explosions in... Here he goes, coming to you. Oops. He's on the ground now. We won't step on him. Watch out, Jandre. We'll jump over him and away, and I'll show you some of the other caterpillars. Very common to see caterpillars of one species all emerging in one go. So you see processionary moths, you see all sorts of things. And what they're doing, let me find you a good example. That's actually probably the best example. Is they have actually almost completely devoured this tree. Sorry, trying to hold it still. One of them didn't make it. Can just see the husk of the exoskeleton. Oh, there's a huge one there. Hold on. Get it. There. Absolutely enormous one. Stretched right out. So I'm not sure which butterfly or moth that these are going to turn into. My guess would be a butterfly, not a moth, but you never know. Moth caterpillars can be just as brightly coloured as butterfly caterpillars can, which makes sense. All brightly coloured caterpillars are that way for a reason. In this case, I think it's more camouflage than anything else. They've tried to make them look like something else. Nature's tried to make them look like something else. I'm going to let it go now. Spring back up. It's not really, to me, it's not quite aposematic colouring. Ants, this is now getting ridiculous. Between my toes as well. And what we've got here is a whole collection of caterpillar, what's it called again? Frass. It keeps going out of my head. Caterpillar frass. And it's completely scattered around this area. So there we go, in between the rocks and the dirt of the sand, there's tiny little pellets of a caterpillar excrement, known as caterpillar frass, and it's spread out all around the base of this tree. So there's a huge amount of caterpillars, and when I say they're everywhere, they're everywhere. There's one here, there's a whole load along here. They're absolutely everywhere. I'm going to go and find out, I think, what particular species of, well, not I think, I am going to find out what particular species they come from, because they've almost completely devoured this tree. They really have. I mean, the silver cluster leaves in some areas have thick, luscious crowns at the moment. And James Dungan, you wanted to know, what do they pupate into? Ah, oh, there's a little one. What do they pupate into? James, I'm not sure. I'm going to look it up. I'm going to try and work it out. There's a whole load of them. Sorry, Jandre, I'm just having a look here. I'm fascinated by how many there are on this trunk. I'm trying to work it out. I will have to go and look it up. I don't know each and every caterpillar. I'm not sure whether any of the guides know. I'm going to guess butterfly, but it could be a moth as well. It could be a moth species. And some of them really do look like as though they're about to pupate in the not too distant future. So it's going to be some sort of moth or butterfly. The question is which one. I'm definitely going to be trying to find out, because they have seriously affected many, many of the silver cluster leaf trees that I've been seeing over the last few days. And it's clearly something that's very seasonal. Hold on. Oh no, he's gone into a hole. I was going to show you a variable skink, which is a type of, oops, careful, reptile. Like a landmine here at the moment, dodging these little guys, all scooting along. Bill, you wanted to know whether or not we use any kind of insect repellent, and I just want to try and double check and see if we can see any more of them on the other silver cluster leaves trees. Highly mobile, Jandre. Highly, highly mobile. Highly mobile caterpillar. We do use mosquito repellent or mosquito spray, some of us, in different ways, shapes and forms, and in the different brands of them, just in terms of trying to at least protect ourselves from having our knuckles ravaged in the middle of the night, or our feet or our ankles at the dinner table. I don't see any on here. And sometimes when I'm walking, if I'm thinking about it, I'll put some on because it seems to help with the ticks. But we don't tend to use all that much. We've got a lot of mosquitoes around at the moment. Lot and lot. More mosquitoes than I think I've ever seen in my entire life at one time. There are so many mosquitoes. And there's no caterpillars on here. Are there any other silver cluster leaves close by? No. Fascinating. It's going to be very interesting to find out exactly what that particular caterpillar turns into, and whether or not the adults are as beautiful as the caterpillars themselves. So a lot of caterpillars take on a very aposematic colouring. The bright darks, yellows, reds, blacks, things to warn, to say, don't eat me, I'm dangerous. Or they go the opposite approach, which is to try and camouflage themselves. And there's something called a processionary moth that we don't see here, but are so sweet. They all walk together, they're little hairy caterpillars, and they all crawl together in a procession, hence the name processionary moth, with the head of the bottom of the front one and the head of the next one directly in line. So they look like a stick on the road. Well, that's the idea, that they look like a stick on the road. I'm not sure that birds are fooled. Birds with their incredible eyesight, I doubt, would be too bothered by that. But there's different approaches by different caterpillars. As we go off in search of all wonderful things, I'm sure you're very excited to hear how Brent's quarantine search has gone. Let's head over to him to find out.
Oh, well, we've checked three in a row, Pan. Alas, Mr. Q is not here. Wonder where he could be. I think I definitely might come down here bright and early tomorrow morning, once they're going to be nice fresh tracks all over before everyone else is out. But in the meantime, I think I'm going to start heading back towards Juma, maybe see if we can find Queen Karula on Juma. She's around there somewhere. Hopefully we're going to be able to find her. But other than that skinny herd of buffalo, I think we've seen one impala on cheetah plains, so it's a bit quiet. It does seem to be quite a bit drier here. As I said, if we don't get rain soon, the little grass that has sprouted. Oh, Vim has spotted a bird of prey. Well spotted, Vim. It's one of my favorites with its orange or yellow eye and very distinct pose. You can tell immediately from a distance exactly what it is. There we go. It's a brown snake eagle. Isn't that gorgeous? You can see those legs without any feathers and very heavily, heavily skinned and very tough to protect against snake bites. Now we have seen one of them alive eating a snake before, and it wolfed it down. So even if you are a deadly venomous reptile, there are things out here that have an eye for snakes and a belly for them too. It's just so quiet. Even the bird calls, not many out here. It is one of those. What's the word I'm looking for? Oppressively warm afternoons. And we're going to get a few more of them as the summer rolls on. Better than being cold, though. And we are still experiencing some radio problems at the moment, so I can hear 1 out of 5 from what Final Control is saying to me, just so they know it, so they don't think I'm ignoring them or ignoring your questions. Of course I'd love to answer your questions, I'm just not able to hear them clearly at the moment. Hopefully maybe once I'm through this dip and up onto the next rise, we should be able to get them again. We are experimenting with a new comms system that once we get it all sorted will make our communications infinitely better than they were. So you're just going to have to bear with us while we get it all fixed up. Okay, let's try. We should be up on top shortly. Be able to hear Final Control now. we're right up on the ridge. Hopefully. There we go. Well, the joys of modern technology. Hello, Sarah. Sarah says today is the Remembrance Day for lost species. If I had the power to, what extinct species would I bring back? Wow, that's a difficult one, Sarah. Sure. Let me think about that for a second. Now, it's a very, very interesting question, because it's a little bit more complex than you would think. Now, certain species go extinct because they were meant to go extinct. Hello, little piggy. There's a warthog hiding behind the bush there. Now, let me just draw forward, might be a little bit clearer. There we go. Hello. There's that little female. Now, every time I see the warthogs, I am looking for the next set of babies. This is last year's. No, actually, probably 2 years old now. Now, they do generally give birth a little bit later. Sarah, oh, she does look like she's quite fat. Could you be the first mom of baby warthogs this year? And every time I see warthogs now, I'm keeping a very close eye. And it'll be really wonderful to see the first little babies. I have been looking forward to the piglets. They are super cute. Oh, got something good there. Now, you can see how it jumps down to its knees and enables it to get much closer to the ground. Now, there are thickened pads on a warthog's knees that actually even start developing in the womb. Isn't that incredible? So they know they're going to be spending quite a bit of time on their knees. And it's amazing, actually, if you ever get to touch a warthog's nose, how tough it is, because they use it to dig down for tubers and roots of grasses. So very versatile schnoz the warthog has. But Sarah, well, let's think. So it's not. So one of the interesting ones to look at in terms of extinction, and that is a species that's most likely to go extinct in the next 2,000-3,000 years is cheetah. Now, cheetah are more than likely just a failed branch on the evolutionary tree. Now, there's been many, the saber-toothed cats, giant hyenas, cave lions, all those creatures have become extinct naturally. So there's also, to play devil's advocate, a creature like the dodo, which developed on an island without too many predators, etc., wiped out by human beings. But they possibly would have been a... Oh, sorry, I just think I saw... No, it's old leopard track. They possibly would have become extinct naturally if the fossils had started developing into bigger predators. But I think they're not quite extinct yet. If I had to bring them back, there's unfortunately only males left. I think the species I think I'd be most interested to bring back would be the northern white rhino. And I can't just do one. I'd love to see the Tasmanian tiger. That would be a very cool thing. I think the last one died in the early 1900s in a zoo. I think it was the only marsupial predator ever. Could be a really cool thing to see. The Tasmanian tiger. Okay. So, I don't know. I think that's a good one. Maybe we should ask Jamie and Byron what animals they would bring back. Fascinating. Maybe you know what I'd also do. While I've got this magic wand and I'm waving it around, I just... 100,000 wild dogs while I was doing it. Brian wants to bring the Megalodon shark back. How big was that? That was like 20 meters. Massive. It would eat boats. Brian just wanted to film it eating a boat. Okay. Oh, here we go. Ah, final control is back in my ear. Not often I'm happy to say that, but only joking, final control. But let's go to Jamie so she can give you the answer of what creature she'd bring back.
I will give you my answer in a second, but I'm just watching, and I don't want them to disappear. I'm watching the fascinating dynamics at play here. First of all, there is the spider with what I can only guess is her egg sac attached underneath her abdomen. Now, she's been living in this little hole here. Now, I'm not 100% sure what spider she is, and I'm sorry, I'm distracted now because I've just seen two more. But she, I think that is her egg sac that she's got underneath there. It's totally fascinating. And I found a whole load of these spiders all living in these holes. Sorry, Jandre, have a look here if you can. I think these spiders are about to fight over the hole. I don't know if you can see them. They are. I don't want to disrupt their fight. They're just here. Look at this. One is attacking and advancing. The other one is trying to defend its hole. They're two different species of spider, yet they're both after the same area. And now what? One's on top of the other, but are they fighting? Not really. They're just kind of. There it is. I think it's actually bitten the other spider. I wonder if these have got venom. Perhaps not of medical importance to us. This is fascinating. Sorry, I don't put my head in your shot. I'm trying to work out exactly what's gone on here. This is so cool. I don't want to disrupt them. I don't want to interfere in any way. I'm just trying to work out exactly what's going on. I can't quite work out if they just kind of got tangled together. I don't think so, though. I think that was a very deliberate attacking move on behalf of the slightly smaller spider that was the aggressor. Now, the smaller spider is the same species as the female that I pointed out with the egg sac, from what I can see. I'm going to have to go and find out exactly what these spiders are, because I have seen them in all of these old scorpion holes. There's a whole load of these old scorpion holes that are, I don't know if they're still in use or if they've been abandoned. It seems likely that they've been abandoned. It's unlikely that the spiders would be occupying that area. This is so interesting. She's going to go back to the safety of hers, I imagine, with her egg sac. Sorry, let's just see what's happening here. Now, while we just watch these two as they tussle it out or do whatever it is they're doing, Sarah, you asked a really, really lovely question, and thank you for sending that through. I loved Brent's answers, although it's a very difficult one, isn't it? Sarah, I think in terms of, I don't know, I think there's an emotional reaction to it. I have memories of reading about an antelope called a blue antelope that used to live in South Africa, that was much like a sable, just blue-grey in colour. Sable antelopes, very big horse-like antelope. And the blue antelope supposedly was shot out in the sort of early, around the 1800s. And I would love to bring them back. I think it would be fascinating to see them. But of course, as Brent said, it all gets very complex, doesn't it? Because we've had such an enormous impact on animals' lives. I agree with Brent, if I could bring back species, trying to save some of because the Sumatran rhino in certain areas has been declared extinct. I wouldn't mind bringing back Sumatran rhinos. It's a difficult one. There's a part of me, just the part that's fascinated by the whole thing because I love elephants, I wouldn't do it, but I would be interested in the process of bringing back woolly mammoths. But of course, they went extinct for a reason, and they would not. The current climate is not really geared towards supporting them. But can you imagine doing live safaris in the snow somewhere, and there are woolly mammoths wandering around? It'd be so cool. I wonder, I'd love to know if they have structures, herd structures like our elephants, if they relate in the same way as our elephants do, if they're as intelligent as our elephants, if they have the same long lives. I think that would be utterly fascinating. So a really, really good question. Sarah, what would you bring back? If you could bring back one species, what would you bring back into the world? Recently extinct. Of course, there's a whole host of insects, a whole host of reptiles, amphibians that we don't even know about that have gone extinct in recent years. We are, of course, facing one of the biggest losses of species diversity that have been faced in a very, very long time. Right, I'm going to move on from my tussling spiders, although I'm tempted just to see exactly what happens here, but we're going to start heading back in the direction of our lift home. Let's leave the spiders for now. Most interesting. Most peculiar. There's so many things I'm going to have to go home and look up when I get back this afternoon in my insect book. Jandre, what would you bring back? Unicorns, you said, but I mean, if you actually had to bring back something.
Megalodon.
Pardon?
Megalodon.
I don't think I don't think those count as recently extinct, though. I have to be honest. It would be very, very cool to do Safari Live, but in Jurassic Park. You know, because obviously I didn't learn lessons from the movie about how uncontrollable and how it always ends badly because the dinosaurs want to eat you. I think it would be fascinating to do. It'd be so entertaining. Excuse me. Now, Liz, you wanted to know if the if cheetah were to go extinct, what would take their place in hunting gazelle? I think that it would be something that the wild dogs and the leopards could probably keep up with. I know that, of course, cheetah are particularly specialized in those open areas, in keeping populations down. But the number of cheetah are so... The number of cheetahs is actually quite small, and I don't think they have a massive impact. They all play a role, all of these animals do, but I don't think they have an enormous impact on the population of gazelle, more so than something like lions and leopards and wild dogs. So I suspect that it would be wild dogs that would come in, although the wild dogs in that area, of course, have not been seen properly in many, many years. Again, as Brent said, we need a couple of more thousand wild dogs, to help to repopulate the species. The cheetah is such a complicated one, isn't it? Because how do you draw the line between the natural extinction because a species is no longer fitting into its ecosystem because everything's evolved around it? And then you can't really discount human interference because we always do. We've inevitably had an impact on their lives in terms of species, in terms of habitat loss. So it's a complex one, the cheetah, and the role that they play in the environment. But that's how evolution works, I suppose. When one thing goes extinct, naturally, not when human beings play a role, but when one thing goes extinct, there will always be something else to move around and to take its place. When was this, I wonder? Old, old buffalo kill. I'm not 100% sure, but I have a sneaking suspicion which lions were responsible for it, and perhaps even a Birmingham boy was involved. Speaking of Birmingham boys, let's head over to Byron and his.
We've just come back to this beautiful Birmingham male. He's still lying in the shade, just as we thought. It's been a very, very warm afternoon, and I think he's still very comfortable lying in the shade. I'm surprised he hasn't tried to move further into the shade. As we were discussing earlier, there's a lot of shade further in to the thicket, just off to the left. He's been bothered by some biting flies at the moment. Every now and then, tries to snap at them to chase them off. Now, we've had that question about what animal we would like to bring back, what extinct animal we'd like to bring back if we could. I think mine would be, maybe one of two. We used to have an animal in Southern Africa called the quagga, which was a mixture of a zebra and almost like a donkey, a mule. So maybe that could be interesting to see. And then I don't know how far back are we allowed to go, but a saber-toothed tiger, that would probably be pretty cool to see. Gert, what would you bring back? Have you decided?
T-Rex.
T-Rex. So Gert would bring back the T-Rex. That could be interesting. I think we'd have a different type of safari if that was around. I'd have to go out in cages, not vehicles. I'm hoping now, with the sun setting slightly, more sun is being cast onto that lion, and I'm hoping that perhaps he decides that it's getting a bit too warm for him and he decides to get up and move. But he does look pretty comfortable there at the moment. It's a bit of a breeze, so that does help this lion stay much cooler. And now some of you might be hearing a bird in the background and it's calling frantically behind us. Let's see if we can find it for you. We can indeed. Oh, it's actually gone and sat right down at the bottom of your hat under the tree. And it is a starling, a Burchell's starling. And there you might be able to see, there it is. And that's what's been calling that you can all hear. Beautiful Burchell's starling. They've got that beautiful iridescent sheen when the light hits them. It's just hiding in the shade at the moment, but there we go, you can see it calling. Listen, let's listen a little bit. I'm trying to catch little insects, probably little ants or termites around there that it's feeding on. Let's see if it calls again for us. No, it seems to be quiet now. But they are beautiful birds. Oh, I think it's definitely found some termites over there that it's feeding on. Very peaceful at the moment. Hang on, this male seems to have lifted his head. Let's have a look. Let's see, I wonder if he heard or smelled something, or perhaps if he saw something moving through the thicket. I'm going to just scan and see. You know, we always discuss it about these animals that, especially these lions, they do rest during the day and conserve their energy for the night. They're not lazy at all. They're just very, very clever. But they are still completely aware of what's going on around them. So this big male, even though it appears to be sleeping, will still smell and hear any activity within the immediate area, and he'll be very, very aware of that. He seems to be looking around for something at the moment.
Question, Matthew, do lions sweep through their
trunks
like the domestic?
So he seems to have little radio issue there quickly. So Matthew, you wanted to know, do the lions sweat through their tongues? Matthew, I don't know about that. I know they pant very heavily. They pant very heavily to cool down. And they, oh, there he goes. He rolled over. I don't know if they sweat as such through their tongue. I've never heard that before. Now the panting is just to try and cool down, breathing in cooler air perhaps. The elephant bird. Gert says the elephant bird is an animal that he'd like to bring back from extinction. I can see those flies bothering that male at the moment. Joyce, you've asked an interesting question. You want to know if I've ever seen lions laying in water to alleviate the heat. Now, Joyce, in some parts of Southern Africa, especially in Botswana, there are prides of lions that need to cross water regularly to try and hunt because of the delta, the floodplains of the delta in Botswana. There's a lot of water around, and they need to constantly move through water. That will obviously help cool them down. I've never seen a lion actually go and lay in water to cool down. I don't think they enjoy water. water that much, but I've never seen them go specifically to cool down. They'll only go into water if they really have to, if they need to cross it, or perhaps if they're hunting something. So yeah, it's interesting. Although, Joyce, with leopards, and leopards generally don't like water at all. However, I have seen, and I've been fortunate enough to see some very interesting leopard behavior. And I've managed to see a young male leopard actually go into a small little water hole or mud wallow. It was filled with water, and he went and he lay in there. Not sure if it was to cool down or what the reason was, but he actually went and lay in the middle of this pan. Very interesting behavior. I've never seen that again. I only saw it once. But generally, they do prefer, these big cats do prefer staying out of water. And there's flies bothering that male again. Must be quite irritating. Him trying to clean himself and try and keep those flies off of him. Must be quite an irritation. I'm surprised. Usually if they are biting flies around or in an area that the little bugs do irritate them quite a bit, you may find the lions get up and move and try to find another position. We know leopards do it, and we had it with that beautiful male leopard the other day, Tingana. He was feeding on a carcass and there were a lot of flies and bugs around, and he decided he'd had enough and he moved further down the drainage line and found a huge jackalberry, and he climbed up and lay right in the top, or quite high up in the branches. Probably a cooler breeze up there and maybe away from most of the flies that were bothering him. I've seen it with lions too, when they decide that enough's enough and they get up and move. Nice to have this beautiful male sitting with his head up, at least for us. Very nice cool breeze. It's still very, very warm and muggy at the moment, but there is a bit of a breeze blowing at the moment, which does help us a lot. Helps the lion, definitely. Again, panting with his mouth open, trying to cool himself down. Alright, I'm going to spend a little bit more time with this male, just see if he does decide to move for us. I don't think so, because it is very warm, but we'll see. And while I sit here, let's head back to Jamie, who's got a rather large tree trunk.
It has been a thoroughly enjoyable walk this afternoon, and one that I am going home with a plenty of homework in order to look up what the different creatures are. And exactly what was happening with those caterpillars. Oh, goodness gracious, that's going to be a disaster. Go look up what was happening with the caterpillars and the spiders and all sorts of exciting things to find out. However, it is unfortunately time for Jandre, myself and Rexon to head on back to the safety of camp before it gets too dark. So it's time for us to say goodbye. I'm very glad that you were all on the walk with us, and I hope that you had fun. Until we see you on the Sunrise Safari, bye-bye everybody. I'm going to send you back over to Brent.
Hello. Well, we're back on Juma. We're in that area where Karula's last tracks were. And we're just checking very carefully around the treehouse waterhole again. Maybe as temperatures dropped a little bit, she might have popped down for a drink. just want to check that maybe she hasn't moved out of this thick area where we think she was. The sun is very bright. Just that very sickly looking hippo who's been residing here for a day or two now. You can see how skinny he is, his hip bone sticking out quite heavily there. And the oxpeck is keeping those wounds from his fight open. Look at, oh, vampire birds. So it looks like he got quite a beating from another hippo. And oxpeck can see it as a nice free meal. Okay, I'm gonna keep a looking for Karula. Oh dear. There we go. And while we do that, Matthew. Hello, Matthew, who's in Johannesburg. Matthew said, I mentioned that cheetah were a failing species. Could I elaborate a little bit more? Of course I can, Matthew. It'd be my absolute pleasure. So, the interesting thing about cheetah is from the genetics, they can see about 10,000 years ago, cheetah got to less than 100 individuals in the whole of Africa. And they managed to come back a bit from then, since then. And quite a lot of it has been due to human intervention, and not in the way you think. So in quite a lot of areas, cheetah is not a very powerful, big and strong predator. So they generally try to avoid domestic livestock like cattle and donkeys, and they're a bit too big. So they have less conflict with human beings than the other predators. And lion, leopard and hyena have been removed from a lot of areas where cheetah managed to survive quite a long time afterwards due to that fact. Now, the problem with a whole population going down to less than 100 individuals is their defense against disease. And for example, they've done tests and stuff on this. You can take a skin graft from a cheetah in Namibia and you can graft it onto a cheetah in Tanzania or in Kenya or in Ethiopia. So there's so little genetic variance between the remaining cheetah in Africa that if a disease was to get into any of the populations, it would almost certainly completely wipe them out. Now, one of the main reasons about having good, healthy populations is that disease factor. So you'll have a whole bunch of different individuals. Some will have genetic markers that make them less liable to get white muscle disease. Some will have less likely to get distemper. Now, what's happened with a cheetah, there isn't all that information. There's only X amount from that sort of whatever, I've forgotten the exact figures, but it was about, I think it was 50 or 60 cheetah left in the whole of Africa 10,000 years ago. So there's no genetic variation. Now, if you look at human beings, quite often you'll choose your mate subconsciously based on the fact that they might have immunities to different diseases, and that to a degree happens in the wild as well. So cheetah don't have that option. They can't choose another mate that's going to be immune to canine distemper or white muscle disease. Now, the other thing that makes cheetah not such a safe bet for the future is their breeding structure is so completely different to any of the other big cats. It is the only cat that needs a male bias in numbers to produce offspring. So you need more boys than girls, which is very unusual. And everything else, one male leopard, multiple females, a group of male lions, multiple lion prides. Cheetahs, a female, to actually stimulate ovulation, she needs to reject sometimes three or four different males before she's going to be ready to mate. So that also, when each male's generally got an area of maybe 60,000 acres, and you need a lot of space as well. And so that's not a very effective breeding structure. And then, of course, another major problem is that the lack of genetics is also compounded by the fact that free-roaming groups of cheetah, there's big gaps between where the different individuals are. So even if there is a little bit of genetic variation, it's very difficult for those animals to move through and meet up with them. So it is an interesting one. And I know it's a lot of people who I think that, oh, it is very sad, but cheetah probably without anything to do with people destroying the habitats or shooting them or anything, will probably go extinct naturally in the next 2,000 to 5,000 years, or even shorter. Maybe even one disease can wipe out 50% of the population, especially the interconnected populations. So it is an interesting discussion, and sometimes not all extinctions are bad. As I said, sometimes extinction is just that. It is a failed branch on the evolutionary tree, like a saber-toothed cat or a giant hyena, or what's another good one? That funny thing. Oh, I'm just, give me a second. I remember it now. All the hunting hyenas. Those were actually pretty cool. Now imagine a hyena that had long legs like a wild dog and was able to run like a wild dog. Those became extinct because they became over-specialized, and they were competing with wild dogs, and they lost a lot of the things that make hyenas strong and good. So they lost stamina, they lost jaw strength, and then they immediately had another animal they're competing with. So it is a very interesting thing, and a lot of people like to make things black and white, Archer. It's like this, right? It's never, unfortunately, like this. There's always a lot of gray in between. I mean, a great example is the Nkuhumas and the white muscle disease. I know a lot of you believe we should have got involved, and I'm afraid I sit on the opinion we firmly did the right thing, and all the Sabi Sands did the right thing. You don't get involved. That's nature fixing itself. We've had a massive drought. The buffalo, we saw those buffalo today, they're still looking horrible. And now, if all those lion cubs survived and they keep whacking buffalo like they are, and with all those mouths to feed, the buffalo population is going to take a bit longer to recover. So there has to be something to keep the predator population in check. And things like white muscle diseases, which I had no idea about till it happened to the Nkuhumas, and mange, and those things come out at the end of droughts or during droughts, and you'll find sometimes there might be, during excessive wet season, there might be another disease, rot foot or something, for example, that might come out to control the herbivores if they get too much. So we like to get involved, we like to interfere because it makes us feel good. It's got absolutely almost zero to do with the greater ecosystem. So I mean, we look at, we often sort of focus directly on the Nkuhuma pride because we see them all day, but if we look at lions in the Great Kruger National Park, they're fine, they're happy, they're healthy, the population is great, good genetic viability, there's a good dispersal of males between different areas, there's always high mortality rates with lions, but cubs, but there's a lot of lions and they're doing well in this open system. So the death of two cubs in the grand scheme of things means absolutely nothing, and the lionesses will breed again, they'll have more cubs, or they'll get killed by something else, and or a male lion will come in and take over from the Birminghams tomorrow and kill all the remaining cubs. So we don't know, but nature tends to work itself through those things and sort out those problems. And at the end of the day, humans get involved for selfish reasons because it makes them feel better. There's my two cents. I'm going to stop harping on. Hello, Impala and beautiful golden light. Well, Sarah would like to bring back the psilocene, an extinct bovine. Well, Sarah, wow, I'm going to have to look up what that is, Sarah. I'm not quite sure. So I presume it's a big cow-like animal, like in a rock, maybe. But I'll definitely have a look up on what that is when I get home tonight. Well, those impala are looking very relaxed. Sarah would also bring back a rock, so I guess Salicin is very similar to a rock. I actually watched a very interesting documentary on rocks, and I did quite a bit of reading up on them not that long ago when I was on leave, strangely enough, and about the attempts to breed rocks with some cattle that might have once, but I don't think they're proper rocks. I think they are extinct now. But there we go. Well, at least, so I'm guessing a silatine is something similar to an auroch. Now, while we continue our search for the sneaky queen of Juma Karula, let's go back to Byron, who's sitting with the lazy male lion.
So he's still sitting with this beautiful Birmingham male. He's moved about a meter and he's just moved into some shade, a little bit more shade, but that's it. But his head is still up. And I'm just wondering, it's so difficult to say if he's going to move or not. You never know. And there's still this cool breeze blowing at the moment. So the temperature has dropped slightly. Oh, that's a big sneeze. Do you see that? Okay, a little yawn. Well, we know usually yawning is a good sign because they'll start, there we go, trying to get oxygen, and he may get up and move. Exactly what he's just done. Oh, wonderful timing. Isn't that great? See, he's limping a little bit. Now, don't worry, everyone. This happens fairly often with lions after they've been lying down for a while, especially males. I've seen it quite a few times before. They'll get up and they'll start limping. The reason for that is they're probably just quite stiff from lying down for so long. And I'm sure as he starts warming up, that limp may just actually go away. Oh, that's wonderful. That is great. Our patience has paid off. I wonder if there is any water around, because I'm sure... What is he going to do now? All right. He just wanted to move out into the open. Well, at least we got to see him move. But I do think maybe it's those flies that were bothering him a little bit too much in the end, and he's trying to roll in the sand a bit. But you can see, I think they're still around him. That's how the tail's flicking. This is a beautiful area that it is in at the moment. And I think photographically, I think we would have got some lovely pictures of him walking there just into that, or towards the golden light. And we'll show you the sunset shortly. It's almost setting. Oh, there we go. It's on. So I was watching the lion. But you can see that beautiful sunset. Look at that. And especially if you're a photographer, this male lion walking into the sun would have given you beautiful golden light. This is a great time of the day. Great time of day to have a look at, or to photograph wildlife, especially big cats, because generally they do have this yellow or golden yellow coloration, leopards and lions. So you, with photography, you really don't have to change much of the photograph. You can just make sure your settings are correct and you should be able to get a wonderful photograph of whatever big cat it is you're trying to take a picture of. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to move around a little bit, because if it is facing the other way, I think we're just going to have better light and a better view from the other side. So let me just drive around quickly. Shirley, you want to know if the lion's diet will change from buffalo now with all these baby impala around. around. Now, surely, to be honest, lions will definitely catch a baby impala if they find it. But the thing we need to realize is that it's not a substantial meal for lion. That's literally a small little snack. So, and I'm just going to park like this. How's that? So, lovely view of that lion and that beautiful light on it at the moment. So, Shirley, I think, generally speaking, because there's not a lot of meat on an impala lamb, and it's probably quite a lot of effort to catch a small lamb for the amount of food that they get, generally lions would prefer larger prey. Let's put it that way. Leopards, however, leopards will definitely be benefiting from the impala lambing season at the moment. It's a great size kill for a leopard. It's a perfect meal for a single animal. Don't have to share with anyone. And easier to hoist into a tree to keep out of reach of other predators. So leopards do hunt a lot of impala lambs this time of year. And I remember in the past, areas that I, or having worked in these areas before, this time of year would be tricky to find leopards, because what happens is they end up catching young impala lambs, and then what they do is they take them into thickets and they hide them in a little thicket and they feed on the ground, and you don't see them for a day or so. It becomes a little bit more difficult to find them. I just want to actually try move, sorry, this aerial out the way. The lion's changing positions, we changing positions. It's keeping us guessing. There we go. But he's definitely being bothered by those biting flies. His tail is flicking furiously at the moment, or fairly furiously, trying to keep the flies off of him. Look at that, and you can actually hear it. Let's see if we can hear it. Hear that tail every now and then, that little shame. It's not happy at all. I wouldn't be either. I'd definitely be very irritated by those flies. That tail's very, very thick and powerful, and a lot of muscle in the tail. You can hear every time it hits the ground, it hits it with quite a thud. So, Chai Connie, you'd like to know if I think maybe this male has pulled a muscle, perhaps, and I don't think so. Like I said, I've seen it many times with male lions. They might get a bit injured in a fight with one another or when they're hunting, and sometimes hurt their paw or something could happen. I don't think he's pulled a muscle as such, but when they do lie down for long periods of time, they'll lie down for most of the day. It might be an old injury or just a strain and a bit stiff, but once they get up and they get moving, generally it works itself out and they'll start moving around fairly easily again. But it's hard to say. I don't know. It's just from past experience that I've had and past lion sightings with lions getting up and limping. It definitely depends on the lion itself. Now, Mary, you'd like to know how far this lion traveled from yesterday. Now, I'm just trying to think. I actually don't know where this lion was yesterday. So we don't know. We actually didn't see them yesterday, I don't think. So, I'm not too sure, Mary. I think, to be honest, I think it may or may not have been possibly about 3 or 4 kilometers, I think. But I'm not too sure. I don't know his exact last position from where we are now. Michael, and you're a new viewer. Welcome to Safari Live. Great to have you, and thank you for sending your question. And you wanted to know if I've ever seen a pride's takeover before. So, Michael, I haven't. I've seen prides kind of fighting because they've bumped into each other in one another's territory. I have seen that once or twice, and that can be very, very violent. Now, in the area I used to work in, just south of here on Londolozi, we had a coalition of four males, which were known as the Majinga Line, and they patrolled that area for many years, since 2010 to about 2000 and... I think the beginning of this year, end of 2015, beginning of 2016. They passed their prime now and they've been pushed out. But before that, there was another coalition of five brothers, in fact, that used to patrol that whole southern and central part of the Sabi Sands. Those males, eventually what happened was, as they got older, they split up, which I think is kind of what's happened with these Birmingham males. We tend to see the two males fairly regularly. This male, Ntinyo, and the other male... whose name I can't remember now, Mfumo, I think, and Mfumo, and these two males have kind of been moving around in this territory for quite some time. The brothers, I think, have been a little bit further east, and that happens at times. So what happened in 2010, those coalition of five, they split up slightly, and we had two big males dominant on Londolozi that stayed in that area for quite some time. And what had happened was they heard a coalition of males calling in the north one evening. And they came and investigated, and they bumped into one of the males. And this was also a coalition of five originally, and they bumped into one of the males. And these two males from the Mapocho killed this male from the Majinga Line. And we unfortunately didn't get to see it, but it's very interesting how the takeover occurred. Because what happened was they killed this male, and then all that that noise and that commotion alerted the four brothers that were still up in this area in the northern section, and they headed south, and they caught one of the Mapocho males, killed him, and the other one ended up fleeing to the west, and he met up with his brothers, and they basically stayed there until they eventually died. Now those four males then slowly but surely ventured further and further south, taking over the territory that used to belong to the Mapocho, and those Majinga Line became very, very successful in that area for many years, for about 5 years. So it was an incredible takeover, very violent takeover. Two males were killed in the process, but those four males then came in, took over the territory, and new genes were introduced into the area, which is very, very important, and which is what happens. Usually these takeovers occur in the evenings. You might be lucky and you might find lions fighting during the morning if they've bumped into one another, and often what happens is you hear them calling and roaring, and usually that roaring is enough to chase the one pride away from the other one. So that is usually what happens. But I unfortunately haven't seen an actual takeover from a coalition. We've seen the aftermath the next day, but never seen the actual fighting and the aggression that is shown. I have seen males fight with females before, which can happen. But it all depends. It all depends on the area. It depends on the territory. Ilana, a 13-year-old viewer, good afternoon or good evening, Ilana. It's almost evening here. You want to know how old or how long does it take for a male lion to fully grow that mane? And Ilana, it's usually on average between 5 and 7 years for a mane to grow out fully. And I think these males, I think, are around 9 or 10 years old, if I'm not mistaken. So they're still in the prime, between 8 and 10, if I'm not mistaken. So they're still kind of in their prime. I think that's why we don't have any other males challenging them just yet. Maybe later. Those beautiful paws. That tail's still flicking around. Alright, we might sit here a few more minutes. I know some other people are interested in trying to see this lion. I don't think he's going to move anytime soon. Still very comfortable lying out in the open, so I may just leave him fairly shortly. But nice to see him get up and move, though. And while I do that, let's head over to Brent and get an update from him. I think he's got some baby impala.
Well, it looks like all the impala decided last night and today it was time to give birth. There's literally, I must be 30 little babies on quarantine at the moment, all around us, little ones everywhere. Now, last tracks of Karula, we're heading in this direction. So that is dangerous for them. Now, at this time of the year, leopards really like going after these little impala. Look at that. They're just so sweet and wobbly. Now we're going to get to hear, maybe not just yet, but as they get a little bit older, when you hear mom and babies talking to each other, it sounds like burps, but little contact calls between the females and the little ones. Look at that, isn't that just too wonderful? Summer is truly here, the trill of the woodlands kingfisher and the joy of baby impalas. Okay, let's move forward a little bit. Now, there's a whole bunch off to our right here. There's some more to the left. If I go really slowly, I'm hoping we can get a bit closer to them. Oh, there's the little one drinking. Look at that! Oh, he's got burrs. I thought it was flies for a second, but that is burrs from walking through the grass. Thirsty, thirsty little chap. Well, we can't see if it's a little chap or a little girl. Let's try and get a little bit closer. Now, the mums are going to be super alert at the moment, trying to protect these little bundles of joy. Now, of course, leopards aren't the only threat. There's threat from above, martial eagles. And of course, wild dogs are probably the most efficient at getting baby impala. I've seen them eat 9 in about 25 minutes. But they're still a little jumpy. But they will get used to us very soon, as their moms are very relaxed. Here we go. Can you hear the woodlands kingfishers? Can almost imagine Karula sitting on the edge of quarantine waiting patiently. Now, Susie thinks they are very adorable. Indeed they are, Susie. And impala have a spectacular success rate. I mean, they're the most numerous antelope in Africa south of the Sahara. And their tactic is, I mean, they have so many babies that generally quite a few will survive to replace the ones that have been eaten through the year. Well, like with all animals, they have fluctuations in their populations, but generally out of all the animals, they stay quite stable. Oh, running. Gonna run past here. Oh, there we go. Gangly legs. Oh, look at that jump. You go, little one. So cute. Hello, Graham. Graham's wondering, what is the purpose of those dark patches at the bottom of an impala's legs? Those are called metatarsal glands, and what they do is when an impala runs away and kicks, it releases a pheromone. As some people used to think that it was to confuse the predators. I do not believe that for a second. And I think what happens is they release that. So once they've been scattered by a herd of predators, I mean, the herd has been scattered by predators, they're able to reconnect and join back together. Okay, well, isn't that wonderful? Wonderful little impalas. Now, I just saw Rex and Jamie on their way back, and they told me the last tracks of Krula were heading into this area towards the western edge of quarantine. We know how much she likes it around the Galago Pan, so I'm going to take a quick drive around there, have a look there, see if there's any sign of her there, and we'll check all around this area. Hopefully she pops out. Guys, keep an eye on the Juma Dam cam, you never know, she might pop out there as well. Just so many little ones. I mean, they've all must have been born in the last 48 hours. Such a wonderful temperature at the moment. It has been a scorcher of a day. Ellen is wondering, do impalas rely more on their sense of smell than their sight, especially when it comes to mothers recognizing babies? I'd say the sense of smell and the voice, and they vocalize to each other, would be probably the two most important ones. Their sense of sight, of course, is incredibly important when they're looking for predators like leopards and lions, and wild dogs for that matter. Okay, now it's unlikely the Krula would try stalking an impala out in quarantine. It's way too open, that she'll be spotted too quickly. She would probably wait for them to move to the peripheries, like around here, where she's got a bit more cover to work with. Okay, let's go have a look. I just wanna actually, I think she might be heading towards Galago if she's come through this direction. I wonder, with the Inkahumas being quite spread out now, whether we're going to start seeing more of Karula back on Juma, now that the lions are going to start moving all around, with the buffalo and the zebra and the wildebeest spreading out and going to areas where there's better grazing. Quite often, as we found last year, the Inkahumas then would move to the north and start following those herds up into Buffalo's Hook. But you never know, each year is different and the rainfall is different each year, so we'll just have to wait and see what happens. What was that next to the termite mound? Is it half light? It is not Karula, it's a log down to the left of him. See that, just that log sticking out there. I thought it might be something. Okay, well, we're going to continue our search. While we do that, let's go back to Byron.
So we're going to now, it's almost time for us to start looking for some nocturnal animals. The light is decreasing, but still not quite dark enough for the spotlights. It's not going to help us at all. So we'll just drive around a little bit longer while Brent is looking for Karula. I hope he has some luck. She's been very, very elusive today. But you never know, she could pop out at any time. That's the joy of leopards, is you never really know where they're going to be. It has cooled down a little bit, so perhaps we are in luck and she does stick her head out fairly soon. Still no sign of any elephants though, which is very disappointing, but that's the way it goes sometimes with there being lots of food and water. And I wouldn't be surprised if they've gone into areas which have prominent rivers perhaps, so there's a lot of water, a lot more water for them. Ilana, you want to know how big can a herd of elephants get to? Now, Ilana, it's interesting because in some areas, so out here, generally from what I've seen, the largest herd of elephant I've seen within the Sabi Sands where we are has been about 80 elephant. But I think what's happened is in that situation, a few herds came and joined and met up and moved through an area together. I think that's possibly what happened. In other parts of Southern Africa, like Botswana, you can have huge herds, 100, 150, 200 elephant moving through an area together. That can be large herds. So it varies. Generally in this area, herds range from about, there was a little bird that flew, I couldn't see what it was, a bit too dark. But generally in this area, the herds range from anywhere between two or three elephant up to about 15 or 20, maybe 30, a fairly large herd for this area. But having said that, like I mentioned before, you may have some herds meeting up and moving through an area together. I'm trying to hear if we hear any little owls yet, perhaps. Maybe the little pearl-spotted owl or the scops owl. Pearl-spotted owl's got that beautiful, beautiful whistling call. Lovely little call. They're very small, only about the size of my hand. So very, very small little owl, not always easy to find. And we still haven't been able to find many chameleons. We are trying, we are looking for them. They seem to be elusive at the moment. I think we need perhaps some more rain. Maybe they just have decided that there's not enough rain for them yet. Oh. Sorry. Leopard. Surprise, this leopard's busy stalking that impala. I'm just gonna sit very quietly, everyone. I don't want to disturb the leopard. That impala just saw the leopard, unfortunately. It's a little bit open here anyway for this leopard to try and stalk this impala. I'm surprised she tried. I wonder if this isn't Karula. As I said, you never know. leopard could pop out at any time. She's been seen already. The impala's alarm calling at her. That's why she's sitting up. Have a look at that. Isn't she beautiful? Sure. Thank goodness I didn't drive over the leopard. It's almost like she was using the vehicle as I was driving. She was trying to run right next to us. Oh, such a pity. Unfortunately, she wasn't lucky with that impala, but that happened so quickly. And like I said, it's very open here. There's actually nowhere for it to hide. I'm surprised she was trying to stalk that impala out here. But it just shows you they're very opportunistic. And she's definitely on the hunt, it appears. Well, that impala was very, very lucky. Oh, isn't this an amazing surprise? This is so great. Let's follow her a little bit and see where... Looks like she is trying to hunt. Wow, she's going right into that little thick area. Now, I think what's happening is she's trying to hide away from that impala. Because she's been seen, she's lost that element of surprise, and she's trying to perhaps move away so that she doesn't attract any attention to herself from this impala. That is incredible. You see, everybody, it just shows you never know what you're going to bump into out here. And things can happen in a flash. And wasn't that such an incredible surprise? I saw the impala, and that's why I tried to dim the lights, and as I did, the leopard ran next to us. We didn't even see her. She must have been stalking that impala. I'm not sure where she's going to go now. She does move through here. It might be a bit harder to follow her. And also, to be honest, it's wonderful to see her, but I don't want to follow her through a thicket now. And I'll tell you why. Because she's moving around, and she's clearly interested in trying to hunt. So if she stays close to the road, we'll follow her. But if she moves off through the thicket, we don't want to move and break branches and basically attract too much attention to her. But let's see which way she goes. She goes. All right. Sorry. There she goes. Amazing, this stealthy predator moving through the thicket. That is really, really wonderful. So who needs chameleons when you bump into a leopard? There she goes. Thankfully, she's still staying close to the road. I can actually hear some great go-away birds calling already, but I wonder if they're calling at her. I mean, it's quite far away, and it sounds like the alarm calls, but I highly doubt they've spotted her. They're calling quite far from here. Looks like she's coming back down towards the road. I think she's going to be in front of us shortly. Have a look. There she goes. Look at that. Look how easily she can disappear through this thick bush. Now, this would be an ideal area for her to hunt in. Much thicker, moving through the drainage line. Let's see. She seems to be zigzagging a little bit. Now, back on the road again. So, potentially just zigzagging, having a look around. Is there any potential food, potential prey that she could possibly try and hunt? This is really very, very special to be able to follow a leopard like this and see what she gets up to. trying to scan to see if we do spot any impala or anything, so that if we do see it, we can just back off. So we don't disturb her. It's amazing the distance a leopard like this can cover in one evening while she is off hunting. And we know Karula is such a she's such a successful leopard when it comes to hunting. She's been looking after her two cubs very, very well, always providing food for them. So she is a successful predator. Watch, you might scent mark. There we go. Just a little bit of scent marking there. This is her territory, so she does have to move around and scent mark occasionally. See, this is more her type of terrain. Can you smell that, Gert? Mm. Now, that scent that the leopard has just left behind, and I've told people about it before, it smells just like popcorn, buttered popcorn. And you might think I'm going crazy, but I promise you it does. And it was a very, very strong smell that we picked up there. I just want to see if she's seen something. She's probably heard something moving through the thicket off to the right. I don't see anything, but she maybe just thought she heard something. Let's see, she might come back onto the road again. There she goes. So that scent is a very, very strong scent, and you can smell it immediately when you drive past an area that a leopard has scent marked. And it does smell a bit like popcorn. Incredible smell. And James, Richard, you say Karula clearly popped out of one of the potholes or something that Jamie suspects she uses, perhaps. You know, leopards are very, very stealthy animals, and if they want to hide away and not be seen, you're not going to see them. Now, I think a female leopard like this, what she probably would have done is hidden in a drainage line somewhere during the course of the day while it was so hot. Now, as it started to cool down and under the cover of darkness, it's a lot easier for her to hunt. And I think that's why she's decided to start moving around again, potentially look for some prey. See, I'm just trying to keep quiet too at times, just see if there's anything around that she's potentially trying to hunt, not disturb her too much. But let's see, she's approaching Philemon's cut line now, which is right out in the open. So I'm going to drive around quickly and just see. I think we'll get her coming out and maybe walking past us. Let's have a look. Scan and see if there's any impala around here. There, she's coming towards us. I'm just gonna wait here. There she is. So I don't want to shine directly in her eyes. I'm just going to shine off to the side. But have a look at her. Beautiful. If she turns sideways, then I can shine a bit more onto her. Look at that beautiful pattern. This is very, very special. What a great, great sighting. I do think we are going to lose her soon. If she, yeah, she's going to cut straight across. And I say that because she's going to go straight through this quite a dense thicket. And you'll see now as she moves past us, it's going to get very, very thick. And there's a lot of trees, fallen over trees and stumps. We won't be able to follow her through there now. And as I said, with her moving through a thicket, I don't want to disturb her if she is trying to hunt. Moving through trees and breaking branches will just disturb her and draw more attention to her, which we don't want to do. But what a wonderful sighting. Wasn't that incredible? What a great way to finish off the sunset safari. And there she goes. Hey, wasn't that incredible? Now she's heading down towards Twin Dams. Give me a second. I think Brent's trying to get an update from me. Go ahead. Negative. She's crossed straight across Philemon's cut line at the moment. We're about 200 meters to the west of Philemon's dip or Weaver's Nest junction. She's mobile south, mobile south. I'm going to stop following her from here though. Yeah, let's just see if we get one more glimpse of her. But you can see, have a look everyone, how thick it is around here. We wouldn't be able to follow her through there, not at night. And as I said, you know, we've had such a wonderful sighting of her. We do still want to be sensitive and respect the leopard while she's walking through thickets like this at night. She is clearly trying to hunt. Who knows, maybe we're lucky and we find her tomorrow with a kill and perhaps with those two little cubs. At least we know where to start looking tomorrow morning. We know which area she's headed into. But she can cover a huge distance in the evenings. So it all depends where she decides to go and hunt. I can't see her anymore. Alright, she's definitely moved off. What an incredible sighting. Lovely, lovely surprise. That really was a great surprise for the evening. Let's head back to Brent, get an update from him, and see what he's looking for now.
Wow, wasn't that awesome? So great. VM and I literally had just done Rebecca's road, so we must have just missed her. She must have been just ahead of us or behind us, but it seems like Byron's got all the leopard luck or lion luck as well today. We're going to see if we can find any small nocturnal critters. I wouldn't mind seeing a civet. I haven't seen a civet on drive in such a long time. Now, of course, around the lodge, always a good spot to look for, oh, bug in the face, certain little creatures, civets, jennets. Never seen actually a honey badger close to Juma Lodge before. We've always seen them quite far away, which is quite interesting because at home we often get honey badgers trying to raid the dustbins. Hello, impalas. We don't want to blind them, that's why I've switched off all the lights. Oh, and a waterbuck will turn. Oh, another waterbuck. Oh, everything's on quarantine this evening. Oh, look at that. Oh, could we get a nice silhouette there, VM? Let me go back a bit. Oh, now the waterbuck's put down its head. Come on, lift your head, waterbuck, into the sunset. Or carry on eating, your choice. Looks like it's going to carry on eating. It doesn't want to give us the silhouette at sunset. There we go. And down again. Hello, Rebecca. Rebecca is wondering about all the things that crew lights are they able to see in the dark. Well, Rebecca, they can, not as well as lions and leopards or as Karula can, but they are able to see in the dark, but better than us, but still not as good as the predators. But at night, they also rely on a lot of their other senses, their hearing, their smell, to detect the location of predators. If they hear something, they'll just focus in, put their ears forward, and then start smelling and looking to see if they can possibly find what is going to attack them. Now, I'm going to check one of my favorite bush baby trees quickly. Now, I think, unfortunately, I think the bush babies have changed their route. So they used to always be here, but that's because I think they were feeding a lot off acacia gum. But now that it's rained and they've got lots of bugs to eat, they don't seem to come here every evening anymore. So I think we're gonna have to try to figure out where their next route is going. You know, remember, we went and checked one of our favorite bush baby hidey holes last night, and we found a squirrel hiding inside it. Naughty squirrel. Okay, no bush babies, no chameleons. I think we still need a little bit more rain to see lots of chameleons. But it has been an exciting safari. And Tinyo and Karula. So why weren't they here yesterday afternoon? Yes, we did have a wonderful run with those cats. Just a pity we couldn't keep it going. I was hoping we'd get to 90 days, 3 months, but well, we've got a new goal. But I think that's definitely a dry season goal. It's gonna be difficult once it rains a bit more and the lush grass brings a lot of the animals further to the north. Well, from Vim and myself, it's been absolutely lovely having you on the back of the vehicle. And we will be seeing you again in a few hours, short hours, now that it's summer, for the sunrise safari. So till then, let's go across to Byron for the last few moments of the show.
Oh, what a lovely finish for the day. I'm still trying to find something small and interesting for the final little goodbye. I'm looking for little scorpions perhaps, or chameleon. You never know. Maybe another leopard pops out. That could be interesting. And I know Brent was saying it's a pity Karula didn't show up yesterday and broke our record of the big cat, or big cats every day for, what was it, 80 days. That's incredible. That is amazing though. So we can now start fresh and maybe we can beat it. Who knows? It could be exciting, an exciting competition. Look, sometimes these apple leaf trees are great to look for little nocturnal animals like scorpions or chameleons, but I don't see anything in them at the moment. I'm trying to see if there's any owls around, perhaps. And what we have got is a lot of impala all out in the clearings. Scanning this little tree very carefully. So a lot of impala around, and you might just get a glimpse of their eyes. I'm not going to shine in their eyes, but you can sometimes get reflection on their eyes if I just do this. Let's see, you might see them if you're around. But we don't want to shine directly on them. Their eyes are quite sensitive at night. Turn this light off too. There we go. Well, it's been an incredible day. Very, very exciting. We've had lions and leopards this morning, and again, lion and leopard this afternoon, which was amazing. So very, very fortunate. We always need to remember that. You know, sometimes you can drive around and not see any predators. So when we do have these wonderful sightings, we need to enjoy and appreciate every one of them. I'm sure these impala are all going to stay on the clearings this evening for safety, so they can keep an eye out potentially for Karula if she wanders back in this direction. Unfortunately, she was heading away from here. But they will stay out here and keep an eye out for any potential predators. It's easier for them to get away if they see them out here. Well, from the team, you know, Jamie was on bushwalk this afternoon, and Brent on the other vehicle, and from the ladies in FC, a big thank you to them, Rebecca and Jerry. Thank you to Gert on camera with me this afternoon. Thank you, a big thank you to all our viewers for all the questions. We'll see you tomorrow on our Sunrise Safari. Good night and goodbye, everybody.